Hey everybody, welcome back to Phil's Recap and Review. Game of Thrones, Season 6, Episode 5, The Door, and what a fucking episode of Game of Thrones. To answer your question from right where we just started, Carmine, yeah, I did. I watched this episode this morning, as a lot of people did, as it got leaked this morning, and I made the mistake to watch this morning, because it made my whole day fucking sad. People in the chat were wondering if we're starting late because I was somewhere crying. Yes, I was. Fucking summer. I know everyone's talking about the Hodor, and we'll get into the Hodor. It was the summer, and summer giving up the life to protect them, to buy them one more fucking second. The balls on that fucking direwolf. Way to fucking go. Such an emotional episode of Game of Thrones.
Someone's putting their Lotus in there.
Yeah.
3 minutes.
Oh my God.
Lotus would do the same for you, no doubt.
Oh, innocent.
I hope so. But everyone, welcome back to the show. We are here tonight.
I'd rather face Ghost than Lotus.
It's so much love. We have everyone in the motherfucking chat right now. We got everyone in the Discord group in the spoiler room. It was great to see everybody tonight, and we're going to get all into this episode. I feel a little weird because I come out here and I come out, you know, really excited. Oh my God, this was an amazing episode of Game of Thrones, but this was probably one of the most, for me anyways, beginning to end sad episodes of Game of Thrones.
Oh God, yeah.
It really tugged on the strings. You can talk about the Red Wedding moment, Ned's moment, but those were singular moments. This episode fucking punched me in the balls several times and ripped them out one at a time. I didn't give a shit about the lizards of the forest dying. They dug their own fucking grave. But fucking Bran, you don't go in there. You don't walk into awful neighborhoods without your bodyguard, the Three-Eyed Raven. You're not ready for that. The Three-Eyed Raven could have told him not to do that. I don't know. It's just a really big emotional episode. The Jura scene really hit me hard, too. But I'm not alone. Joe Dirty Locks, Katie Crow, also got Carmine with us for the first part of the show. And really excited to have them and have the motherfucking chat. Everyone, I don't know. We got to pour out some liquor. But Joe, Katie, what did you think of this episode? Because unlike Carmine and I, you two watched this episode right. You are just finishing this episode for the first time. So
they didn't watch it before everybody else?
Nope.
I even sent it to him this morning to watch it, and he refuted.
I did not watch it. I didn't even tell Katie it was out there leaked until like an hour before it started. Mm. So, I kind of wanted to, but then I was like, you know what? I want my. I don't want to be thinking about what happened all day. Mm-hmm. I want it just right off the bat.
We need fresh rants.
Yeah. Oh my, rant, I have no rant in me.
Heartbreak all over the
place. I'm just crushed.
Were you teary-eyed, Joe? Did you get a little teary-eyed?
Teary-eyed. I'm gonna say this. Oh. Never before, ever, in any TV show, there's been movies. I've watched movies, and I've cried. I've cried from the start of movies to the end of movies. But never before have I cried as hard as I cried for any fucking TV show ever in my life. Ever. Not, like, my jaw was open. I was crying. I was blowing my nose. I was just... I'm about to start crying again. It was
horrible.
Horrible.
It was awful. Horrible. And Katie Wolf there, what was it like to see another one of your brethren die tonight? Hodor? Oh, fucking door. But let's go over to Carmine here for a second. Carmine, you and I both, you woke me up this morning with this episode.
Did I really wake you up?
No, I was up.
Okay.
But meaning, like, the first thing I saw in the morning.
Opened his eyes.
I opened my eyes, and I saw a message from you. I'm like, holy shit, the episode's leaked. I gotta watch this now. And I watched the episode now, and it really, again, I was in bed watching this right after I woke up, crying. And I know you're not, I don't know how often you cry or lose your shit, but did you get extra emotional at the end of this episode, Carmine?
Yeah, I thought it was incredibly sad. I got more teary-eyed during the Dany and Jorah moment, but the Hodor moment was just incredibly sad. Holy shit. Yeah. I didn't think they would kill him off of all people.
See, I saw it as soon as that shit started and they couldn't wake Bran up and he was in the compound there, I was like, oh, fuck, this is it. And, like, as it's unfolding, I could see it unfolding and, like, I knew exactly what was going to happen. I knew it. Like, I could see the whole thing coming. And I was like, no, that was part of the reason why my jaw was open was because, like, I couldn't not see it coming, and when it came, it hurt worse than I thought it was.
Joe, what are you talking about? You could see it coming, and then when it came, it hurt you worse than you thought it would. What the fuck are we talking about here?
Eyes were wide open, and it was just
Joe, we're talking about some serious shit. Fuck this. But just go to what you were saying for a second, Carmine. I have to admit, too, the Jorah and Danny scene set me up in a place that made me... like wet enough to be fucked at the end. I was so sad in that moment with Jorah because I think anybody, me personally, I've been that Sir Friend Zone, graduated to Master Friend Zone. I've been that guy in that moment, and then the moment you share your feelings to the girl, you know, you Ted Mosby her right there. You're just putting it out there. Everything, I love you after the first fucking date.
And she finally acknowledges that you're not just some friend, you really do like her. It's just like there's no feeling like that in the world, though.
No, and it's so relatable for guy, girl, anybody that has been in that situation, because it's such a real-life relatable situation. And that had me bawling. Shit, when she's like, you are going to go off, and you are going to find a fucking cure to this, and when
I
you
command
do...
I command you to,
and oh. I thought this whole episode was, and yes, I'm totally sucking the Game of Thrones balls right now. This whole episode was acted out so well in every position that they put them in. Every position that Hodor put Mira in. Mira was amazing in this episode. Just such a great stuff.
Well, what makes no sense to me, and I want to touch back on this because Joe said it. Joe touched on it a little bit. Why was Bran in the vision when they knew the Night's King was coming for them? Why was he in the fucking? Why didn't he get out when she was like trying to shake him out of it?
And what's his name brought him there? It was like immediately after he got touched, and they were like, "Bad boy." He went right back into a vision.
Exactly.
I think I have an answer for that if we're going with some of the speculation shit. And I don't know
if he knew what was going to happen. Yeah. He had seen the future. It's
fair to put this out there. I don't know if I believe this. It's too early to tell. I got to watch this episode like 3 or 4 more times and really fucking think about shit. But there's a lot of people out there that are saying today that this confirms or adds credence to the fact that they're both the same person. That Bran, he brought himself back to that moment. I mean, I'm sort of not talking about it properly, that somehow this is all connected, or he knew that the ink was set, it needed to happen. So he brought his friend back to the moment where he knew that he needed to fucking warp into Hodor, and then fast forward into the future. I don't know exactly why it happened, but I've heard that floated out there. I'm not saying I believe that. I might not even be giving credence to the theory right now because I'm sort of half-assing it, but I have heard that put out there.
See, I don't see the three-eyed crow. That is Bran also. Like, that's a little strange.
You can tell me. It's full of shit. I mean, it's not my... I mean, I'm not sure if I believe it. I've just been seeing that a lot today.
See, what I see about to happen is Bran goes south, they get south, and Bran's going to the Winterfell tree, right? Mm-hmm.
Or I don't know where he's heading. I have a feeling, and people in the chat were saying about this, and I want to get Carmine's perspective on that, on what I'm about to ask. Could this be the time that we finally see Cold Hands, Carmine?
Probably not. I mean, the one thing that really annoyed me about the Kingsmoot was, like, we only see Yara. There's no like other secondary characters who vie for the throne? I mean, we're probably not going to get Cold Hands because the show doesn't like secondary characters, which is dumb because secondary characters make up a lot of the series.
Yep.
Someone said that theory. Now I'm getting into Preston Jacobs' tinfoil episode. Hey, I'm just repeating a theory I heard. If Bran makes the Mad King mad, then the Targaryens are crazy thing is not real. Someone in the chat. King's Moot looked cheap, someone said. And then this is good while we have you here, Carmine, because we were talking about this a couple weeks ago, too. What was your take on the King's Moot in general?
I was just writing the script, too. Fucking... They just made Euron Greyjoy a slightly less crazy version of Ramsay. Like, he's not a major player. There's no horn. There's no, like, crazy motherfucker. Like, Euron is more of a menacing guy than a lot of the other bad guy characters, and they just did not adapt any of that. It was kind of a letdown. Not as bad as House Martell, but still...
So, someone in the chat said, it was almost like he just showed up and said, "Hi, I'm Steve Greyjoy. I want to be the king."
Yep. Hey,
hey, everybody. I think instead of casting him to where I think that they should have cast him, style-wise, the way he looked, I think they cast him to look a lot like Theon. And he does look a lot like Theon.
He really does. Holy shit.
Like it's ridiculous how much he looks like Theon. But I miss he's not what I imagined him as. I think the actor's doing a decent enough job. But I thought the actress that plays Yara on the show, she stole the scene for me. I like that. And speaking of teary-eyed, when Theon starts defending her kind of gets melted by the fact that he actually is sticking up for her, I got a little emotional there too. If I'm being honest, I felt for that. But I agree. I found Euron not as menacing as I wanted him to be. I found him more funny, more like he was eating a little bit.
They use him as a little bit of a driving force. I don't know. She seems to be very smart, right? She's far the smartest of the Ironborn that I've seen. Where do you think she's headed with all those ships?
She's heading to beat him to see Daenerys.
Yeah.
Yeah, look, someone's asked in the chat.
Blood is on Queen Power. Yeah.
he's absolutely headed. They're absolutely heading there. And someone else pointed this out. Euron's like, yeah, just build me 1,000 ships. And
there's a lot of trees on those islands.
I wanna get this, Joe. How long is the 1,000 ships gonna be? Like 5 years to get that much?
At least. I mean, first off, there's no timber on those fucking islands. He did say they took all our ships. Just they took all our best ships.
Yeah.
So they do have ships to get to the mainland, but they have to go over to the mainland. They have to go cut down all the trees because there's not too much fucking timber left on these fucking islands. Did you see? Have you seen them? They look like
rock. Those are some rocky shores.
It's a mining colony as well. Like, it's just, they're going to have a lot of work to be building ships to be catching up. Like, he did
say they could steal them.
What was that, Carmine?
They could steal them from the Tyrells if they decide to do that.
They'll steal them from the Tyrells and from all up and down every ship they come across, they'll seize.
So someone said 1,000 ships for season 15. Next episode, Euron is chasing them in a paddle boat, says Corey Mitchell.
Yeah, that would take 1,000 ships would take a long fucking time to build. Like,
yeah, but not only that, he's offering Dany ships. I mean, she's fucking queen. She can either build them, buy them, or if she's in a hurry, she could just, take some of them from like the neighboring cities.
Yeah.
What are you offering her, ships? I mean, you got to do better than that, motherfucker.
Right. Now, I mean, at this point, she is going to be the queen of all these cities, and she'll be able to build the ships.
Yeah, he's going
to
get the cock. You're right, Katie. He is going to get the cock in there. Carmine and Joe, I'll give this to Carmine, and then I'm curious what Joe and Katie think as well. Do you think that Euron is the one that blew up Dany's ships?
There's actually a really fun theory. I don't know if you guys remember this. Maybe it was Joe who said this. I forgot who said this, but in season 2, when Jorah is meeting Quaithe, there's a guy on the bed who's butt naked, and she's painting him. That could have probably been Euron. So yeah, Euron could also be the harpy who's commanding them to like burn shit and all that. So it's possible.
Well, was it me who said that?
It wasn't you who said that? Well, someone like I really like that. That harkens back because Euron said he's been all over the world, and it would make sense that he's the naked guy being painted by Quaithe in season 2 when Jorah comes to see her.
Ooh, someone did a poll. They sent me the results. What death were you more sad over? Hodor ekes out Summer by one vote, and so but I think.
Where's my vote?
Summer primed you for the
Hodor
experience too.
Ultimately, I wasn't too upset about the death of Hodor of Summer. Mm. Yeah, I would have liked to have seen Summer not die. Leave with them, maybe just use the green creature thing, the children, to do that once, but
I think it opens, Joe, I think what it does is it opens up the Hodor. I'm sorry, it opens up the door to that was horrible. That's fucking horrible.
That was horrible.
Too soon,
too
Phil. Too
fucking
soon.
Sorry, asshole. It opens up the door for Bran to warg into bigger things, like possibly dragons and stuff like that.
Because he warged into the past Hodor to get the future Hodor to do something now. That's some fucking serious talent, right?
That's some Bill and Ted shit. Okay, one gripe. I don't want to get into minor nitpicks, but one little minor nitpick I want to get into, because we haven't talked about the mention of the Blackfish tonight yet, or any of the Sansa and the Sansa and Littlefinger thing that I want to definitely get Carmine's thoughts on before we go. But I do want to point out, we're talking a lot about Bill and Ted stuff with back and forth in time. There's also another Bill and Ted moment where Brienne and Sansa seem to just be okay with the fact that Jon Snow came back to life. There was a line in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure where Billy the Kid, "You seem to be really easygoing about time travel," or something like that. Everyone's just really casual about the fact that Jon came back to life. Jon's brooding, considering what he's been through. Ha 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 ha, he came back to life. And they're just joking about it? I mean, the dude came back from fucking the dead. Is that normal? I mean, doesn't happen often?
It happened before.
Not to the point where Brienne or Sansa have ever heard shit like that before. No. If I went somewhere and I've never heard that shit, and I found out Katie's like, "Yeah, Joe came back to life," I'd be fucking like, have like a finger in my ass about it for like a week at least.
Here's the thing.
I'd be asking questions.
Here's the thing. Even in it, you know, even in our world, right? There was a big problem with burying people alive who we thought were dead. To the point where they used to put bells on the with little ringers from the inside of the coffins to be rung. So it does happen that people are, you know, mostly dead and not all dead.
Mistaken,
you know, I'm not quite dead yet.
Yeah, but this is different. He got stabbed, bled out, and came back to life.
Well, he didn't. He mostly bled out. There was a little bit left. He was slightly breathing, not enough to raise his chest. Like, come on. I mean, shit happens, right? So, like, Shit does happen, man.
Okay, fair enough.
I mean, but take Beric Dondarrion.
They'll deal with it after they take back the North.
Yeah, I mean, Beric was cleaved in half. I mean, that was like, and then he was whole again. I mean, that.
Yeah, but Sansa and Brienne didn't.
Didn't see him stabbed a million times. They only kind of heard about it.
No, he was already up when they got there. Fair enough, Joe. I want to go over to Carmine for a second and get your take on something I'm wondering about, because I can't make a read on Littlefinger. Did Littlefinger know about Ramsay or not? Believe him, Carmine?
Well, in season 5, he even said how when he was talking to Ramsay, he goes, I think he was talking to Ramsay or Roose, he goes, "Well, you're fairly new on the scene. I haven't heard much about you." So I can believe it. I mean, Littlefinger has spies everywhere, but he doesn't know everything about everybody, you know? Ramsay is fairly new on the scene. He just became legitimized at the end of season 4. At the beginning of season 5, Peter meets up with them and arranges the marriage. So I don't believe he knew to the full extent how crazy Ramsay was. So I gotta side with Peter on that. He didn't really know. I don't think he knew.
I'm kind of in your... I don't think Katie agrees with us, but I'm kind of in the same boat that I really believed him, his... I don't know. There was something about the way he was saying it. Maybe he just conned me. I believed it. But I do want to continue with that scene a little bit with you and just go into... He was able to manipulate her again. Carmen, he was able to use his little finger powers at the end to stab one of his little fucking things stuck to the wall there, with reminding her that John's her half brother. It's John's army, not her army. And for whatever reason, Sansa decided to lie to John and lie to everyone about that information. Why do you think she chose to lie about that information?
Oh, me? You want coming to me?
Yeah, coming back to you. What do you think?
I have no idea why she did that. Maybe I don't know, she's trying to be slick in her own way. No idea why. I really don't.
And to go over to Katie now, Katie, so you think Littlefinger was just bullshitting. Because most people in the chat say Littlefinger knew, don't underestimate him. Some people say Littlefinger would. Littlefinger didn't know. What's your take on this, Katie?
Okay, you start with the family sigil. And then you move into the angry, neglected, rejected bastard. Like, you don't have to know the full extent of Ramsay's abilities and his enjoyment. You just know where he comes from and his position in life. And he's going to be a sadist.
Fair enough. Just to start with. Okay, so you think Littlefinger, it should have, maybe he didn't know the full extent, but at least looking at the points, you don't send someone you care to a house that sigil is... is a flayed man, and there's rumors about leeching in their family for historically years, and their father backstabbed the mother. It's forget whether he knew that Ramsay was as crazy as Ramsay was. He should have, just from the information that was given, it was already a dick move. It's kind of
there's that. Yep. Right then and there, he was. The Boltons were part of the Red Wedding.
Treachery, rapey, murdery family.
That is enough to say no. He already had he already had Sansa. That he didn't need to go marry her to the ruling family of the North. I don't know, but someone made a comment in the comments last week. I had said that no, there's no way he didn't know, but you know, he's spending all his time down in King's Landing. He's making his moves. He's got his sights set up. He doesn't know necessarily all the players in the North, all the little guys. You know, Ramsay was a bastard. He's probably not, you know, on everybody's radar. So I can see maybe he didn't know Ramsay, but period. Sansa's right. Is either you didn't know and you're an idiot.
You're dumb.
Or you did know and you're my enemy. So either way, I can't ever trust you.
Yep.
Because you're either completely 100% retarded because you sent me to the people who were responsible for the Red Wedding, and they tortured and abused me.
People in the chat are talking about the baby face. Yeah, I look like I'm a creeper. When I'm this baby face, I think it adds my creepy level times 10. But yes, thank you to people that are listening to the audio recording.
To the local playground.
Yeah, so. I'm still getting used to you without a beard. Holy shit, dude.
Weird. It's weird. It's definitely a bit. I'm not blind to the fact it's a strange, different take on me. I definitely look a lot different. I look a lot friendlier.
I notice your cheekbones too. Holy shit.
It's horrible, dude. Isn't it horrible? I got cheekbones and shit. You don't want to see what's going on in here, dude.
Party.
Fuck you, Katie. Fuck you, Katie. Stop it, Wolf. Don't howl at me. So we've Thank you, people in the chat. You're making me blush. So let's continue. And one scene we haven't talked about yet, and I'm very curious to get everyone's take on this scene before we progress. And that is the Varys and Tyrion with the new Red Woman. I think a lot of that is yada yada yada. But when we get to Varys versus the Red Woman, that whole battle going on between the two of them, I've never seen someone put Varys on tilt like that.
That
make him feel so uncomfortable.
How does she know those things?
First of all, in that scene, Tyrion, Peter Dinklage, excellent. The way he's trying to just, whatever. Let's a deal. And then he's like, Varys, shut up. Because we've all, again, talking about situations we know. I think Joe and I have been in this situation in real life, but in both ways, where I've been the one talking, and Joe's like, shut up. Just don't talk shit to the cops, Phil. Shut the fuck up. And I'm just like, yep.
And vice versa.
Vice versa. Yeah. Where we've both been punching each other. Shut the fuck up. Don't talk like that to that person. You're going to get punched.
We're not the one holding.
Yeah, exactly. And Varys just keeps going and attacking. And at first, Tyrion is so concerned for breaking up the alliance or something like that. But then when she goes, listen, Lord Varys, you know, whatever she goes into the whole thing about when you were a child and you got cut and you heard that voice, you want to know what it meant? The look on his face, he became that little boy again. He became a little boy, and I'll go to you, Carmine, first here. What was it like seeing Varys like that?
I actually really liked it a lot. I've been waiting for this all fucking season. I love when Varys is put in these situations, and that's the first time we actually seen him sweat that much. I mean, Varys normally doesn't lose his cool, but you could kind of tell he, you know, lost his cool a little. And I wouldn't blame him. She knew all that shit, but how did she know? How do they know about that stuff?
I don't. She uses awesome. She not only creeps forward, but she uses touch too. She puts her
the
hand on his arm.
Genius.
Like there's all sorts of things, manipulative techniques that go into what she just did to him. But the big question, like Carmine, how the fuck does she know, man?
Yeah, and then she brings it right around to, and so that's why you can trust me.
Yeah.
What?
How does she know? Did she hear rumors about that? Is she somehow connected to the sorcerer that did that? Does she just
Melisandre did something similar last season. Remember when she was talking to Jon and she goes, you know nothing, Jon Snow. Like, the Red Priestess, they know some shit. I have no idea how the fuck that goes down, but they know something.
That's a very good point, Carmen. I kind of forgot about the fact that she said that, and he just gets that look like, fuck you! What do you know? What do you know? Shut up!
He doesn't go talking about all that to anybody. But we do know he has talked about it to somebody, right?
So I just want to point out that Caitlin posted in the Discord group, if anyone needs to get a definite question that they know that want answered in Discord group, just send me a private message on there so I make sure I get your messages. Someone posted in the chat, I just read on 4chan that Bran is actually Bloodraven, and that's why Bloodraven is stuck in the tree and can't walk. The time travel is getting too much. So that goes to some of the speculation thing I was talking about earlier. So that theory is out there. I'm not saying I subscribe to that theory. I'm saying it's out there and people can be true. Because they've introduced this element into it, it's just an interesting thing to think about and look into. And I pub a lot of other channels sometimes on this, and Preston came up earlier. He did a recent video that's very good if people haven't checked it out. Is Game of Thrones sci-fi now? Or something to that effect. It's actually a very good video, and he makes some interesting points in there. So if you haven't checked that out, check that out.
So is that time travel? Like, if it is...
Joe, you're asking a very important question. What do you go with that, Joe. Go on your rant there, because I smell it's coming.
I'm having trouble. The whole thing, okay, I can understand the flashing back, like the visions and going back and seeing the past and shit. I have trouble with any kind of seeing the future shit, because even the trees haven't seen the future and nothing has. And then you get into the realm of they're in the same space and time. How does that end up happening? Like, I can understand watching and being there on a third plane watching, but not they're in the same plane interacting.
Dude, I got to admit, halfway through that, this is why I don't like time travel, because halfway through that, I just started going blah, 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 mm-hmm. blah, blah.
Yeah.
While you were talking, and I love what you have to say, Joe. But I just, that's where I don't know, maybe I'm just... I don't mind some elements of that poking in. I just don't want to get in.
And where did they get the fucking flux capacitor, dude?
It's very true. Now, Carmine, just out of curiosity, from a general thing, what do you think of time travel in Game of Thrones?
I don't think it belongs, to be honest. I mean, it's a cool concept, but that concept is always fucking blurred, and it's just, you have to do a lot of explaining, and we know they're not going to explain it, because nobody on that fucking writing team is a goddamn scientist, so I mean...
Someone says it's called a causality loop. Yeah, we've seen this shit in Star Trek. It happens in Star Trek. I mean, I don't mind.
It's always poorly explained.
This reminded me a little bit of All Good Things, and that if people have seen that, I'm not going to ruin the episode, but of how the ultimate solution you find out is always happening. It always has to happen. It's all a big circle. I think it's more that than specific time travel. I think it's more... I don't know if we're going to go the route of Bran whispering in the Mad King's ear and all that sort of shit. And I don't know if I want it to go in that direction. I'll have fun regardless. I'll just put my hat on, flip it backwards, and just ride down this fucking...
Well, now does this opens the door. This absolutely opens the door for as Bran gets older and gets more powerful, would he then not try to warg into, in one of these visions of the past, warg into someone else aside from Hodor?
Mm-hmm. Well, there is an article.
Always wasn't a weak mind, but traumatized from that episode.
Carmine, what were you saying about the article?
There's an article, I forgot to send it to you, about, there was an interview with the guy who does the High Sparrow. It was like in Polish or something. It was on Watchers on the Wall. And apparently, the actor who plays young Ned Stark, apparently there's going to be a very big revelation with him and Bran at the end of this season, because he did talk about how before this episode how he would be briefly in episode 5, which he was, so I'm inclined to believe it, that there's going to be a very big revelation that's going to include Bran and himself, and they're probably going to meet each other or have some kind of connection. No idea, but that's what he said.
And I also think it's interesting to note that the moment he decided to bring him back, where we actually got to see Brandon Stark, the other Brandon Stark tonight, and what's Ned's dad's name? Rickard Stark? Is that correct?
Something
like that. So we got to see all of them, and that's a focus. Someone said Star Trek sucks. Yeah, it does. Star Trek super sucks. I love it, though. It's awesome. Young Ned in episode 6, briefly in episode 10, longer, someone says. I agree. Star Trek's daytime soap opera in space. Yeah, it is. It's awesome. Someone said, don't badmouth Spock. Sorry, I'm just jumping to the chat for some Star Trek. I can't take any more direwolf deaths. Bran is Macabre's blue eye. Bullshit, he's not. Then we get some George R. R. Martin issues. Oh, and one other thing before we get too far, I'm going to open it up to some phone calls here in a second. The one interesting line I want to overanalyze a little bit, when Jon is leaving the wall at the end of the episode and leaving Ed in charge, and he says to Ed very clearly, don't knock the wall down or don't let the wall fall down. And was that, could it be more obvious foreshadowing for the wall coming down at the end of the season? I mean, maybe I could be wrong, but I also subscribe to that belief, of, I think a couple people do, that that one of the last things we're going to see at the end of the season, I feel like, is the wall coming down. And that, I just feel like that's happening, or happening at the very beginning of next season. It, whether there's 20 episodes left or just the 13, whether that 13, I'm hoping that that 13 was, they just kind of put it out there to see, and then it's going to end up being 20, but all the reports I hear, generally speaking, is that it's probably just going to be 13 episodes. So it seems like they need to get to that quick. That's the next logical place that the White Walkers go next, after they took care of Bloodraven. Now they just got to head down to the wall, I would assume.
Right, and see, what I see happening is Bran getting to Winterfell. By the time Jon gets that castle taken, he gets into that tree and starts working his magic from there, and that's where they hold off from Winterfell, because it's been said that, you know, 12 men can defend Winterfell with those walls.
Yeah, true.
From thousands.
Well, what if Ramsay wins the battle, Joe?
Yeah.
Enough of that. Enough of that. Okay, so let's take our first call of the night before we get into our recap here. So this is from area code 808. 808, welcome to the show. How's it going tonight?
It's going well. Thank you. It's my first time calling, and I'm excited.
It's really awesome to have you, and I'm sorry that you're calling on such a sad evening, but it is great. It is great to hear from you. What is your question and or comment?
Well, I have several comments. I love Yara, but it takes way longer to build a ship than it does for Yara to get over to Dany. Well, she's gonna rather do Yara than she will want to do Euron.
Agreed.
I'm so on board that Dany doesn't like. Well, she does like Dario, so I don't know. Maybe she might be into
Euron's not Dario. There's a big difference. One is. There's a big difference between the two.
Okay, fair enough. One's a dirty pirate. I hear you.
I guess the other one did kill his captain, the other captains, the other leaders of the his little troop there.
I just don't see Euron being as slick and charming in the
we're supposed to pretend.
Katie, he is not charming.
Mm-hmm. Not
he's all about girl power.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Keep going.
I'm sorry, Burroughs, he looked like he was going to pee his pants when the Red Woman talked to him.
and we know from biology of how everything's going on down there. That would be a very messy situation if you had to.
That would be a nasty situation. I love Sansa. I loved it when she gave John the jacket that she made. That was so warm and fuzzy. I love that. And I loved how she didn't take any shit from Littlefinger. And I think that the reason that she didn't tell John was because she was protecting him, because she knows the Tullys won't follow him because of Catelyn.
Yeah.
And that they'll follow her.
Good.
That is a great point. A great point.
And thank you so much for calling. Yeah. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you. And I love you, Katie. Sorry about your loss.
Oh, that's very nice. Very nice, Carl. Thank you so much, Carl. I want to go to something Carmine said in the chat that's funny, because where's Euron's eye patch, someone was asking. And Carmine said, the showrunners need more budget for killing off Summer, so no eye patch. Yeah, they
there was no point in having that fucking wolf be killed off that easy, other than they need to ease the budget for more crap. Yeah. There is no point. That was just fucking
right. That felt really weak, especially where 30 seconds later or 3 minutes later, you have the fucking Child of the Forest doing the exact same thing. And like they make it like we're supposed to feel bad about her dying too, when all they did was set up for, oh good, okay, fine, that's what you deserved that.
Well, they created these creatures.
Have a good night,
they
lady.
Right. To save.
Like, so I felt it was a waste of killing the wolf. So it didn't really sadden me as much as it upset me. Yeah, it made me more angry with the choice, rather than, especially to do the same thing with another character 30 seconds later in this, like, immediately down the hallway. Like, okay, now, like, and then they did it with Hodor. Like, three of them. They did it three times in a row. But the Hodor one, really, that I cried.
Well, they drew that one.
The Hodor one was done the best from just a scene standpoint, the way it was set up and mixed with the flashbacks and hearing that kid, the young Willis Walda screaming, "Hold the door, hold the door, hold the door," was just freaking horrible.
Let me see. I would have thought, like, this is what if you know, producer Joe would have had that wolf outside the door ripping arms off of the creatures that are sticking through, ripping a corridor.
Yes.
That's what Joe would have done. That's what I would have been like, no. We can't have that happen three times in a row. Put the wolf on the outside, chewing off arms until Hodor is gone, and then take off and catch up with Mira and fucking Bran.
That's good.
So I do want to pop in the chat, because before this comment rolls by, Lazy Bazooka, who has a great, amazing picture of Danny DeVito going on that I'm loving. Nobody at the King's Moot cares for the fact that Euron kills his brother. Fucking fail.
Nobody gives two shits. Kill whoever, whatever lord or king you want to kill in Westeros, have at it and have his seat. That should be the fucking, like, come to Westeros and be a lord of your own. Yeah. Murder and rape and rule the land for your own.
If you can slay, you can rule. <No, right.
laughs> Well, there is a reason behind that. I think it's because not a lot of them liked Baelon. They thought he was a fucking idiot. I mean, he had a bunch of the Ironborn just hold strongholds and castles, and they're not those type of people. They can't fight in the field. They're just Vikings and pirates. They're good at coming in, fucking your shit up for like 5 minutes, and leaving before reinforcements come. Yep. They focus a lot on hit-and-run tactics, not, you know, capturing fortified positions. They suck at that.
Someone in the chat said it well. He was quite the douche, so it was fine. It was fine.
But, like, let's there's, you can count all the lords that have died, not just that one. Like, there's Ruse, and, I don't know, the list goes on and on.
Nobody liked Aerys either, but everyone still gave Jaime shit for being a kinslayer.
Yeah,
Iron Island's false strength. Oh, and someone also said, I think Bill said, scrolling up about the boats, you're going to need more than 1,000 boats to get the 100,000 Dothraki over to Westeros.
Right.
Yeah, that's what, like, 2-3 days of construction?
Right, you're going to have to be, like, shipping back and forth across the Narrows for quite a while.
You're going to get, like, 10 Flokies going on there for any fuck I'm talking about.
At least 10 Floki.
At least 10 Floki, yes. 10 scary-ass Floki. So let's take a couple more.
Well, just how long does it take to bend planks? How long does it take for a plank to bend and stay bent and be bent for, like that should tell you right there, like, how many planks they're going to have to bend.
So we have a friend, Lee, who's doing this with modern technology, and it takes him years to
bend. Oh, that's right.
So I don't know. I don't know. And he's doing it with a team of kids, too. So I'm not. Let's take a couple more calls here. This is from area code 626. Welcome, 626. How are you tonight?
4 years.
How are you doing, Phil?
I'm doing well. How about yourself?
Excellent. Love the show. Me and my wife dig listening to it and shooting back theories. But my question for you tonight is, do you think it was wise for Sansa to refuse the army Littlefinger wanted to give her? And I guess part two of that question is, now that Sansa wouldn't accept the Knights of the Vale, what do you think Littlefinger...
You ended up getting cut off here, but I think I know where your question was going there. I'm going to bring this one over to Carmine first. Do you think that Sansa was wrong refusing the Knights of the Vale, and what do you think Peter is going to do now?
Yeah, she was fucking wrong. Look, I understand you're upset at this guy that he basically arranged the marriage between you and your torturer, but let's set that aside for a minute here. You want Winterfell, the Knights of the Vale have one of the freshest armies in the fucking kingdom. They have not, them and House Martell, have not committed any soldiers to any battles in the past 2 years that the show has been going on. So she was kind of dumb and not taking it, because I think they have around 20 to 40,000 men, and the Boltons have around 5 to 10,000, including Umbers and Karstarks. So that could be decided right now if she wanted it to, but she doesn't want to.
I want to jump into the live chat for a second. Going into the chat, Stevie Nick says, Sansa is far from wise. And the Finn says, Sansa's a moron. No, Sansa should have taken Littlefinger's offer. Nomad QQ says, Sansa's dumb, man. No, Sansa was dumb. I feel so bad for Hodor. Sansa is dumb. I just see a bunch of, and lying to Jon, Sansa dumb, fucking stupid, even as tough. Someone says, I'm still pissed at Ragnar at the moment. You let a woman like Lagatha go?
I'm still pissed at Ragnar. I'm not sure I take Littlefinger up on that offer.
No, I go to Blackfish myself.
Dude, I'm not sure I'm down with that either, because you got to remember, you got to be thinking, part of you has to be thinking that even though that's a Tully, and even though whatever Peter Baelish just told you, Tully married a Frey and walked out of the Red Wedding on 2 feet. And so, however he's got his castle back, you still have to believe he's in bed with the...
He's a legend, dude. Like, I think it's funny that they are awesome that they refer to him as a legend. I guess what I'm saying is I would have liked it if she thought about it three-dimensionally and thought about it, well, I'm just going to get the Knights of the Vale on my side, and I'm going to fucking kill Littlefinger, and I'm going to manipulate Robin. And I'm going to take over this manipulation.
Exactly. She could have thought about doing that, but, I mean, come on, dude. You're letting your feelings get in the way here. You got to think about taking out the Boltons as quickly as you fucking can.
Exactly. You use Littlefinger in this situation, then you take him out. You have Brienne on your side. Brienne can literally cut him up anytime she wants him to. Littlefinger's stupid enough to be alone in a room with her. He'll still keep doing that. So Brienne will slice him up anytime he wants. And then Robin is one... Touch outside the pants, weird cousin action, smile.
You kill Peter Baelish right then and there. Do the Knights of the Vale turn around and leave?
They don't give a shit. But that's why you use them first, then you kill Baelish. You make sure you get Winterfell back. And then once you're in charge of the North again and you're queen of the motherfucking North, then you have Littlefinger fucking hung and put on a spike on the fucking front of Winterfell. And, yeah, don't wait that long. And then the Knights of the Vales can go piss off all they want. I think they're going to thank you, because most of them probably are like, the only reason we follow Littlefinger is because Robin makes us.
Yep.
So I don't think they're that loyal to him when it really comes down to it. They're loyal to Robin.
I just think it's awesome that even though he put on that Stark coat, he's still not legitimized. There's still nothing to his name
talking
to
about
be
John.
Called a Stark. Yes.
You're talking about John.
So
it's because it's connected, because Sansa, that's how Littlefinger fucking manipulated her again. He entered that thought into the equation. And if you look at Jon's face in the scene when she's leading the meeting with Davos and everybody, he's looking kind of like, what's going on here? Sansa's making sure because Sansa says something along the lines of, no, they'll follow me because I'm the true Stark. And then she like feels the room and realizes that Jon's kind of upset, or at least this is how I read it, that Jon was kind of upset by that. And she goes, well, Jon's every much the son that of Ned Stark that Ramsay was. That Ramsay was to Roose, so Jon counts. Jon totally counts. But I think like she's getting wrapped up. I think Littlefinger's disease took in her a little bit right there, where he like put a little discontent in there of Jon's your half brother. Don't ever forget that. And she needed to pull rank. She needed to pull out her I'm the real Stark here. I'm Queen of the North, motherfucker. Mm-hmm. At least that's how I read those scenes in that situation. Sansa had the nerve to compare Jon to Ramsay. What the fuck is this, Timo? And she's saying that from the fact of Ramsay's hot and Jon's not, is I think what Timo's saying. Robin is having Littlefinger thrown through the moon door before season's end, says Joe Madden. And Jon is a Stark and a Targaryen. That sounds dirty. Sansa's going to die now. White Walkers aren't scary since we know their origin now. Someone's saying that they're going to become the Borg. Someone suggested that to do another Star Trek thing. So let's take another call here. This is area code 347. Area code 347. Welcome to the show.
Welcome to the show, Big Fucking J.
Motherfucking Big J. Welcome. How are you doing tonight, my friend?
Yo, thanks for the music, my buddy.
Oh, no, thank you.
I thoroughly enjoyed it.
Thank you. Thank you for asking for it. Thank you for everyone that was pushing
You're blowing me. Up. You guys are fucking blowing up since Better Call Saul days, man. What's going on?
We're
the new ball. Everything. You guys are getting fucking syndicated soon, man.
Oh, dude.
Whoa,
fuck that.
You got your special fucking guest, Carmine, coming on. The guy knows everything, like every inch about the show. I love it, man. Blowing up. I love to see my friends get fucking big, man.
Dude, thank you so much.
Yeah, talking about, how you doing, Katie?
I'm good, how are you?
Every time I listen afterwards, I always hear Katie saying something. I always forget to say hello to her. Listen, I think that you and Joe should have a benefit. You guys should cut your hair off and have a benefit to get like a dildo and put it on Theron, man. You know what I'm saying? I think that might work.
I think you might be onto something. I think you might be. Big J, I think we should do this with Joe, though. I mean, I think this is more a Joe thing.
Yeah, nah, you guys got to relax, man. But, you know, this guy's fucking pathetic, man. I mean, I feel bad for him. Like, I want to cry for the guy. Yeah. Old uncle's telling him. I mean, every time the guy is just starting to, like, make a stand again, he's like, hey, sit down, you little fuck. They cut your dick off. Ooh,
yeah,
you know,
I'll put your
sister. And I was assuming it's just one and off, right? If I'm on the right path here.
Yep.
And now, where were they going?
I think they're going to see Danny because the uncle was like, I'm going to take my cock and go fuck Danny, yada, yada. And I think they're going to try to beat him too there and be like, you don't want to mess with that guy. But
he had to throw that in with the cock, right? He's like, I got a big cock. You got no cock. Like, he really had to say that.
There's a lot of parallels, too, between Danny and her.
And Yara, absolutely.
There's a lot of parallels between the Danny and the Yara.
Yeah,
they both have boobs. And I do want to say, I also want to say that Theon needs to make his way out to Essos, whatever, because we need the three cockless wonders all in one scene today. Together. We need to try to get Varys, Grey Worm.
Well, that's what I was getting at, too. They both have a eunuch by their side. They've both been dethroned. Oh, they're both on the run from their home place.
Can't they throw a little sprinkle around? You know, grow some of that fucking wood back there?
I think what is dead may never die, but rise again stronger. I think they need some starfish magic going on there. They need to get
or some Viagra.
Little
above. One more thing.
Concoction.
That guy's the creepy fuck, man. Littlefinger.
Oh, God, yeah.
Himself.
Yeah.
That guy's got a heart. I mean, he loved that other guy's wife, right? He loved her. But other than that, the guy's got no heart.
I think it's what he
I've never seen a show. You know, I married Gandhi. I've never seen a show where there's like 20 stories in one story. I guess it's all going to come together, though, right?
Yeah, and that's what it seems like. Yeah. That's the hope, and I think George R. R. Martin, the guy who wrote the original books, said that it was eventually that everyone would start to wander back together, and the places that we start would kind of come full circle, and the people would start to come back together. I think that's why you see the show, which wants to end quicker, the creators want to end it quicker, and not... So they're kind of pushing people together. So with like the Sansa team and everyone like that. So Big J, as always.
One more thing before I hang up.
Do it.
Keep blowing up. Keep getting big. You guys are awesome. I love you. But bro, if they kidnap me and they ever call you, just tell them to put a bullet in my head before they cut my cock off.
Big J, we all got your back here. People are showing you lots of love in the chat, too, Big J.
Don't worry. If they do take your cock, we'll make sure we get to the cock merchants first.
Exactly. We'll make sure we get Big J to the cock. That is our friend Big J. Thank you, everyone in the chat. Showing Big J some love in there. And fucking fetch you, Theon. Yara, fetch me a wooden cock. Give it to me. And where the fuck's Ghost?
My wooden cock.
Is Ghost just another dead direwolf? So here is let's take another call. Let's try to clear the phone decks before we kick into our recap. Take a couple more calls. This is area code 985. Welcome, 985.
Thanks, Phil. This is literally exhausting me. I feel like I need to see a heart doctor, a brain doctor, a chiropractor, an eye doctor, maybe even a proctologist. I don't know.
But make sure you hold the door. Just hold the fucking door.
Oh.
Not when the proctologist is knocking.
We're talking a lot about this Iron Island stuff, and I don't know. This is kind of bothering me because, you know, you hear stuff like D&D saying they don't have enough stuff to do. What was it, 7 more episodes to make it a full 20 or whatever, if my math's probably off there.
Mm-hmm.
But, they're not going into enough detail. You could easily have given many more scenes to Euron in this episode. It bothered me that Euron didn't have blue lips. I don't know if that bothered anybody else.
Yeah, I was talking about that.
No, and a great call. Keep going, my friend.
No, yeah, it's just... Like, you know, it's not as bad as Dorne yet. I just don't see where they're trying to go with it. Yara's sailing off to God knows where, and he's trying to build 1,000 ships. Does he even know how many men it takes to man 1,000 ships? I don't know.
And I want to go over to Carmine for a response to this. Do you think the King's Moon and everything that they did and everything with Euron, do you think that with the episode time, should they have brought in Victorian too and really done this up if they were going to do it? Should they have really jumped all full on in, do you think?
Victorian, who is Balon's other brother, I can understand why they don't have him in there. I can clearly understand. But this episode was around 52 minutes. It really was. And it's for Game of Thrones, that is incredibly short. What I don't understand is, why don't... And I had to cut this rant from my fucking video, too, because I'm probably going to piss off a lot of people. But what I don't understand is, why don't they show other characters vying for the Greyjoy throne? Because a part of this world, what makes it full and big, is these secondary characters. I mean, in season two, we had Dagmere basically coerce Theon into killing those kids, burning Winterfell, and killing Maester Luwin. And the fucking guy is a secondary character. We only see him for like 5 episodes. Secondary characters make up this show, and they never fucking put these guys in. Ever. And that's what really annoying about the Kingsmood. And Euron just didn't have enough personality for me. I hyped him up a lot on my fucking channel, and now he's just a slightly less crazy version of Ramsay.
Exactly what he is. And it fell flat as soon as he got up off the ground. Okay, now let's go kill my niece and nephew. And
no, it's right. No, you joke. Make sure you say it right. It was, now let's go make murder. He specifically says murder. He goes, now we're going to go make murder.
His mustache at the
same time. He goes, where's my niece and nephew? Good, now let's go murder them.
Let's go murder them. Yeah, let's go have some fun.
Yeah, that was kind of...
Oh, I think we have a message from the Fingers?
Hello. Phil, Joe, Kitty Crow. I just wanted to say, I've always looked at Sansa as the captain that I can actually achieve in this world. Anything that Catelyn asked for, I dare not refuse. If I could not break Catelyn, I'll break Sansa as well.
Oh my god, so fucking
remember,
creepy.
I will do anything to get what I want.
Fucking Littlefinger.
He's got the accent down pretty much. It's basically what the motherfucker sounds like at this point.
Fucking, hey, good job is all Littlefinger.
Yeah, he's got that.
Mo Kalen to Molestown Town Express. People continuously talking about the Littlefinger. I forgot to mention this was talked about a lot in the chat. The Littlefinger's portal gun that he has that can the fast travel through all of the World of Warcraft. I mean, the World of Westeros that he did.
You know what I thought was precious?
Precious.
The movie Precious, Joe?
Precious.
No, keep going. What did you think was precious?
The ginger love story.
Oh, God, that dude's face.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes, he amazingly good stuff. So let's take this call. This is from area code 202. This may be our buddy SM. What's going on, SM? How's it going, buddy?
Down.
Hey, what's up, man? Just call me Jay.
How's it going, Jay? I like calling you SM because it reminds me of the horrible S&M. Sexual act. Yeah, S&M. So I'm like, I get turned on every time I say your name. But I'll try to remember to call you Jay.
SM. SMBD.
That's cool anyway. But I got a lot of things to say. Don't hang up on me preemptively.
Do it.
John was all the way dead. He was all the way dead. He was dead longer than a day, Joe. It was not
of course he was.
Situation where the dude was mostly dead. He was I also wonder if that also means that people will try to get into the Night's Watch, bring a Red Priest with them, and then learn how to sword fight and other shit they need to know, and then have someone stab them in the chest and then have that Red Priest revive them so they can get out of it. I wonder if that'll become a habit later on. Everything being done is under Peter Baelish's plan. With the Boltons are weaker now because they have lost Roose and they have Ramsay leading them. I don't know if that was exactly his plan, but somehow I think he sent Sansa in there to weaken them by planning things in Ramsay's head, or Sansa could be a spy for him, giving him the information. So either way, I think it was in his plan. Everything that was done with Charm Travel was always the way it was supposed to happen. It's just causality going around. The Red Priest need to have a meeting about who the fuck is Azor Ahai, because you got one over here, it's Jon Snow, one believes it's Dany, one even looked at Tyrion like he was Azor Ahai at one point. Sansa should tell John in private about what Peter said, even if she told that story to protect him, she should let John know in private.
Yes.
That's how she knows, because not knowing the truth will hurt John later. I would rather have the R plus L equals J theory answered than the how is Hodor Hodor theory or thing happen answered. The amount of people didn't seem to the amount of people that Yara and Theon had didn't seem like enough to sail all those ships.
Mm-hmm.
She does need the Knights of the Vale, but Sansa can still get them by talking to Robin. She doesn't actually.
Yes.
I mean that's the thing.
What's the name for that? Sansa would never outsmart Littlefinger. You need a Tyrion or a Varys to do that.
Yeah.
And if she did, I would just call that bullshit writing.
Bam.
Because Peter has proven to be one of like the three smartest people left in the entire story.
I'm gonna put you on hold. I'm gonna put you on hold for now. Good points for S. I'm not gonna hang up with you. I will connect back with you in a second. I just want to give a couple of other people some calls that have been on hold for a long time. This is area code 601. Welcome 601. I know you've been on hold for like a crazy amount of time. What's going on?
Hey, what's up, Felix? Hey, guys. How y'all doing?
Doing great, Heath. How's it going, buddy?
Good. I just got two quick questions, and I got a statement for Carmine. Number one, one question, where is Theon and her sister going with the ships? Nobody even talked about that. I mean, are they going to rape and pillage, or are they going somewhere to hide? What are they doing?
Yeah, I think
that's a cool scene. Like at the end of the whole series of having the big battle, you know, with the walkers and everything, where Hodor, maybe Bran is like warped into a dragon and he has to kill Hodor. Because let's face it, Hodor is going to, you know, he's going to become one of those.
So you're saying Hodor is going to become a scary wight, and so is Summer.
So sad, yeah.
To answer your first part of your question, I think they're heading to
Daenerys. Right. Yep. I'm sorry, guys. I was just going to tell Carmine, our love of Game of Thrones surrounds and binds us together. He'll know what that means. I'm sorry.
Aww, love necessary.
Our love for Thrones, it surrounds and binds us together, and it's just the start of the discussion, mate. I know what you're talking about.
Fucking great stuff, right? Great stuff right there. Let's take area code 718. Area code 718, welcome to the show.
Hello?
Hey, what's going on?
Oh my gosh, hello. I'm a first time caller. I can't believe I got through. Yay.
No, thank you. Thank you for your first time.
How are you guys?
We're doing great. You were going to say a first time crooner. You were going to sing to us. I'm a first time.
Yeah, I was just blanking out for a moment. I was not expecting you guys to pick up. That's why. I love you guys' show. I've just been kind of lurking in the background, but decided I wanted to call because this episode is just jam-packed, and there was a lot going on. It was very emotional, but I just wanted to make a few points, I guess. I totally agree with Joe. I think he said it earlier that the way they killed off Summer was just ridiculous. I mean, I think it was a total waste, too, because she was kind of in a no-win situation. She was already completely outnumbered, and she just died right away. She didn't even get a chance to be, like, a true savior wolf, so I think that was just completely wasted.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to get you guys' opinion on what you guys think about the fact that the Night King was able to touch Bran. Do you think this is something the Blood Raven kind of knew and knew that this was the way things were going to unravel? Did he know that Bran was going to get into that situation? Because he didn't really seem surprised.
Mm-hmm.
Or actually, he did seem a bit surprised when the Night King touched Bran and Bran woke up. He seemed a bit surprised about that, but everything else afterwards, like having Bran like warg into Hodor and all of that, he seemed very calm. Like he kind of knew it was gonna happen.
Yeah. Great call. Thank you so much for calling, and we'll touch upon that. So what do you guys think about that, Joe and Katie? First, what do you guys think?
I think the Three-Eyed Crow just didn't want it to happen so quickly. But I think he always knew this was going to happen.
Yep. And Carmine, do you think the Three-Eyed Raven knew that, or I think he knew that the Night's King could touch him? I mean, I think One minor thing I want to talk about, because we often talk about like the spoilers, what we don't want to be spoiled and stuff like that at times. I wish they actually kept that out of the trailer. In retrospect now, I wish they kept the fact that they had the Knights touch him out of the trailer, because it still meant a lot to me, but that's a really big moment to show in the trailer. So what do you think about that, Carmine?
Yeah, no, I agree with you. It's like the Terminator Genesis trailer where they showed the entire movie in the fucking trailer. I don't think they should have done that. I agree with you. I think they should have saved that. As for the Night's King touching him, I don't think Bloodraven knew that could be possible, but in the back of his head, he knew something had to be... something like that could be done, because as we see, Green Sight, isn't that like... That has a lot to do with the Children of the Forest, and as we saw, the White Walkers are a product of the Children of the Forest.
And
so,
they said that before, too.
Huh?
They said that before, too. Last season, they said the same magic that created them is what keeps them out of this place.
Exactly. So, he had to have known, in some respect, that would have happened. But I still think he should have warned Bran ahead of time. Like, hey, don't, you know, if you see the Night's King, get the fuck out of there. You know, don't let him touch you.
Yeah, I agree. He should have given him warning. Like, don't go back there without me. We never actually saw that. Maybe he did, but they didn't show it on screen. When someone says, yeah, to build my rafts. Yeah, my name is Captain Jack Ura, and I survived Davy's English. Arr, my dreadlocks are fucking amazing. Save a hero, the boat. Commander Leroy Jenkins. Sad Tope says, I swear the next time someone asks me to hold the door in the elevator, I'm going to fucking kill them.
Yeah.
Sad and fucking
poetic. Down in tears.
And Timo says, yeah, he could have at least went on a trip to the Tower of Joy. He didn't need to go to the White Walker home. Why did he go to the Tower of Joy to check that out?
What you should do is anybody out there who gets asked that, they shouldn't, like, kill them or anything like that. They should just fall on the floor and start kivvying, yelling, hold the door!
Hold the door!
Hold the door!
Hold the door!
Really freak everybody the fuck out who's not a Game of Thrones fan.
We got a couple more calls.
And who is?
Clear the decks. And this person's been on hold for a really long time. Area code 989. Welcome to the show.
989.
Oh, hey, Phil, everybody. Nice to talk to you guys. My comment is kind of a little bit nitpicky. It's just like I don't understand the point of why they're doing it. With Blackfish's army that he supposedly has conjured out of thin air, because the Lannister army needs the Tyrell army to invade the Landing, because presumably they're busy in Riverlands fighting the Riverland army. So how is Blackfish in any fucking position? Somehow they still have soldiers after 5 years of war and the Red Wedding, and yet he's got soldiers to help us take Winter. How the fuck does that work?
Good question. Good question. Let's go over to Carmine first. What do you think about that, Carmine?
Because it hasn't been 5 years in the show. It's only been around 2 to 3 years in the show. And basically, they really pass over this, and I hate that they do this. The Freys are given the House Tully lands. And the Freys are in charge of, you know, keeping a lot of the castles occupied. So Blackfish probably just took it over from the Freys, rallied some of the loyal river lords to his cause, and just took it over. Not all of the Lannister forces are in the Riverlands still. A lot of them went back home. A lot of them are at King's Landing. So
that is a good point. They should stop yada yadding stuff with that. If they actually we keep going to this thing, and I know it's an easy thing to keep bringing up, and people keep bringing it up. You only had 13 episodes. You say you're running out of material. Like, that's how you fill up material. There's plenty of shit they could have explored.
Pretty much.
Blackfish, they could have showed us the Blackfish, who is a legend, who Davos says later in the episode, a legend. How did he get that? I mean, we know he's a legend from the stuff he did in the past, but it's probably post-escaping the Red Wedding. If they had showed us some of that throughout the years, touched in with them maybe occasionally, it could have filled up some more time. We didn't necessarily have to fast-track everything. I love this season. I think this season is a thousand times better than season 5. Not that I didn't like season 5 at all, but I'd say season 5 is probably my least favorite of all the Game of Thrones seasons, and I think in general most people agree with that. I would put this season so far, halfway through the first season, at probably third as my third favorite season as of right now, and has a chance to put up. But they are really speeding things up, and they really are taking things at this like crazy pace. I like, but I like it if they weren't doing it for the reasons why they were doing it. They weren't doing it because they were trying to get the story to close easy. If it just felt more naturally progressed to this point, like it did in season 4, for instance, which is which I feel like everything kind of happens at a quick pace, but as everything leading up, all these big closure points converging in one. But I feel like the quality is very much up, but I feel like they could very easily have done 20 more episodes, 30 more episodes. This isn't a complaint more than it's the complaint like when I get into a fight with someone I care about because we want to see each other more. When you get into a fight with your girlfriend or your wife because we need to spend more time together. That's like a good fight to get into.
Yes.
The fight of Game of Thrones is, it's a fucking awesome show. It's based around, even if it's its own entity altogether, separate from the show, there's enough material to do their take on to have this show last 12 fucking seasons. You know, 10, 12 seasons of good stuff.
Well, what I can say to you is HBO does not have a good track record of having shows run 7-8 seasons and keeping the quality. Like True Blood, I used to love True Blood.
Yeah, you have that. True Blood disease. But
dude, I used to love True Blood, and then they just continued, and it just the writing started to be crappy.
Especially from the moment Tara became a vampire.
That was stupid.
Oh my god. Yeah.
But what Game of Thrones should do is instead of 10 episodes. 12 episodes, 13 episodes, and I hate to say this, because I know I'm going to get shit for this, but I want to say 80% of the show is people standing around talking, so they can't stand around talking for a couple more hours? I mean...
I absolutely agree. If they had started from season one with 12 or 13 episodes, 13 episodes probably would have done it. They could have put so much more from each of the existing, so many more of the side characters. We would have gotten Bloodraven. We would have gotten the Witch on Acorn Hill. We would have gotten Cold Hands and Lady Stoneheart. And we would have gotten so many more Victarion and
Patchface.
And Patchface. And there's so many more characters that we could have gotten if they had just made this another three. Strong Belwan, right? Like. Come on, Benoit Balls, why didn't we have him? Come on!
And I mean, I don't want to get too down that road because I'm happy with what we got. It's just, it seemed like an easy fix that they could have made to add a few more episodes in. Let's take a couple more calls here. This is area code 949. Welcome, 949. Can you hear me, caller?
949, that's California.
Going once, going twice.
Hey, what's up? Can you hear me?
Oh, I could just hear you, and I hung up on you. Please call right back, and I'll take your call. I'm like, yeah, I can hear you. Blow them
off.
Fuck you. No, here we go. This is area code 954. Sorry about that. I disconnected from you. Area code 954.
Yes. Two things. I think Cold Hands is coming. I just got on, so I don't know if you guys talked about that. If it's not Cold Hands, they'll combine the storyline with Uncle Benjen. That's my first.
Uncle Benjen.
Combination, how they meld the characters. Number two, has anybody thought about the fact that now that the Night King can enter past a magic barrier because Bran is marked, if Bran crosses on the other side of Westeros past the wall, is that what leads the White Walkers to the other side of the wall?
Ooh, that's
not fucking bad, dude. Let me I'm gonna take that, please.
Go Carmine. Go on that one. I want to hear your opinion of the caller.
Because the wall, maybe I got it wrong, but the wall was built with, magic fused into it, magic from the Children of the Forest, because they helped build the wall, ages ago. So, yeah, if Mira takes Bran, what I assume is going to happen is, while Bran is still unconscious, Mira can just take Bran back across that fucking wall, not realizing this, with the mark still on him, and that just invites the White Walker invasion, and... There you go. I was expecting them to use the Horn of Winter to melt that bitch down. The Horn of Yeoman, if I said that right. But, that actually makes a lot of sense. Good fucking call.
Yeah, great.
And that led to this whole Bloodraven being Bran thing. If Bloodraven had been marked, if Bran is Bloodraven, then wouldn't Bloodraven have been marked and they could have gone to that tree a lot sooner? And if it is, then how long does a mark last for?
Yeah. Great points, Carl. I hung up on this caller last time, I think I have a feeling too that I don't know. I think you might be right on your first point as well. So area code 949. What's going on? Sorry about that last time.
Hey, what's up? No problem. I just had a quick question. When Bran is in that vision with Hodor. And Hodor. The three-eyed raven is like, okay, it's time for, you to become me. What is he saying? How is that a transition? Like, how is he going to, like, hurry up and have that transition?
Good question. Joe, solve the riddle of life for us there, Joe.
I think it's not like he's going to become me, as in, like, he is now me.
Sitting in the tree.
In that tree. I think...
We love you.
Bran is going south. I think Bran is going to get past the wall again. I think he's going to go right to Winterfell. I think he's going to sit in that tree and become the new Blood Raven, growing old in the tree that's at Winterfell, in the catacombs with his dead Stark family, and that's where the final battle between it all is going to take place, is outside the walls of Winterfell. This is one of the older castles in Westeros. It's got
dragons in Winterfell, Joe. Yeah. Are you a believer of that there's some dragons?
Dragon of Winterfell, I believe, is going to be Jon Stark.
Oh, okay. So
Or Jon Targaryen or whoever, Lyanna Jon Stark, and that's where he's from. He's the dragon of that, and then like the Lion of Lannister, of course. Oh. We have Tyrion and Dany the third hand.
Excuse me while I touch my nipple, Joe. I like you. So so let's get area code 612. Area code getting some new numbers tonight. Area code 612. Welcome to the show.
Hello?
Hey, you're on the air. What's going on?
All right, so basically, I'm about to, like, blow your minds right now.
I want my mind blown. Bring it.
I love getting blown.
Okay, so... Okay,
Joe loves
so listen,
getting blown.
So listen, so basically, a couple days ago, I was digging around, and I found this post on Reddit, and it basically... Okay, predicted everything for tonight's episode.
Okay, I'm gonna stop you for 1 second, dude. Is your talk gonna produce future possible spoilers that might happen? I just want to protect people from because I've read some of those posts too, and I don't want to necessarily go completely there. So please go easy with your spoiler talk here, if possible.
I'll just go on to what I think's gonna happen.
Okay.
Right? I won't tell the spoilers.
Okay, please do.
Wait a minute. What he thinks is gonna happen is probably what he fucking read. Right, so,
in fairness, Carl, I just want to protect some of the people that are out there that don't search that shit out that might be listening tonight. So
I don't search that shit out. I like that Spanish guy. He's a nice guy, you know. I have respect for doctors, but fuck him for spoiling a lot of that. Fuck that guy.
Doctor, I assure you, this is not some doctor.
Okay, so just give me a basic thought, and I'm gonna be quick on the button. So just go easy here. Give me one thing.
Okay, all I'm going to say is I think that a lot of characters we thought were not going to be shown again are going to be shown again.
Okay, that's good. That's a really good point, and I love you. Great call. I'm gonna go easy just because I'm nervous. I get very nervous, and I don't want. And Carmine knows this, and Joe knows this. We said I don't want the armies of you spoil the whole fucking series. Fuck you, comments right now. So I'm protecting myself. I'm protecting myself more than anything else. So. Mm-hmm. So, good point, and I do think that's the case. If you just need to look at the Ian McShane...
Well, I think I know who he's talking about. I think he's talking about the Hound. We all know the Hound is coming back. Ian McShane fucking spoiled that shit.
Yeah, I think if that's what you're talking... We do. We both did videos on that, and Joe and I have talked about that in the video as well. So as someone said in the chat, the Hound, yeah, hopefully Lady Stoneheart, someone says. Hopefully we would get some more Blackfish is coming back. A couple people are hoping for Benjen, a couple things. Here and there, Mary and Bran will be smooching soon. Oh wow, Becca chicka bam bam, Becca chicka bam bam. And let's take one more call right now. And this is from our buddy Jay. See, I did it. I was able. Jay, you're back on the air. Give us a couple more points, Jay.
All right, what's up? I read the situation between Sansa and when she was saying that stuff about I am a Stark. I read it differently than you. I read it as she was just saying, I'm a Stark in name, because I think before that, Davos said, like, the houses of the North won't follow Jon because he's a Snow, and Sansa was just saying, I'm a Stark by name, so they'll follow me or whatever. I didn't read it as she was saying, you're not part of my family or whatever.
No. Same here.
Couldn't Yara have killed that guy when he was like being drowned, going through that ceremony, like as soon as he got out the water before he spit up the water? Couldn't he have just killed him and that old dude right then and just said, all right, now let's do this voting over again?
Yeah, but then what's to stop somebody else from just doing it to you?
Who would want to rule the Iron Island? It's like the best part about it is the ships, and Yara and Theon took them.
Mm-hmm.
So what's your point about, I wish there was more people vying for the throne. I'm just like, who the hell would want to take that throne? What seasons were the first and second best seasons to you? If I'm Jon and I find out that the R plus L D with J theory is two, I go by Jon Targaryen Stark.
Yeah.
Just because those names are really powerful.
I like it. To answer your question, my favorite season's probably season one. It's kinda hard to beat that in my heart. My second one would be season four. And this one's progressing really close. I really enjoyed season four. I thought it had a good pace to it. Some of those Tyrion trial scenes were some of the best in the entire series, and all leading up to it. That was Peter Dinklage's best. Him and Tywin going back and forth. I really like that stuff. But it's hard to beat season one for me. I think that's probably, for me, will always be the best season. In a sense, it was just because I'm biased towards it, because I just love it so much, and I've watched it more than any of the other seasons. Excuse me. Season one hooked me. Yeah, same reason. Season one hooked me, people say.
Yeah.
The Drowned Man ceremony was pretty good, I thought. Someone in the chat, Kendrick says, she compares Jon to Ramsay because they're both bastards, and Ramsay took over for his dad. Jon should represent them too. Tom, I want to thank you for going back. Tom says 4-5-3-2-1. And Tom, thank you. Tom went back and listened to all of our old reviews over the last couple of weeks, and huge thank you to Tom.
Wow.
That's a lot of hours. Really do appreciate that. That's fucking awesome stuff. Winter is coming, episode one. Season one was boring, guys, someone says.
Chuck, I heard someone else say that tonight, too. They couldn't even get through episode one. They tried 3 or 4 times.
Wow.
I said, well, you got to get to episode 9, and you're going to be hooked forever.
So let's take area code 213, and then this will be our last call for a little bit. Area code 213, what's going on?
Hey, what's up, you guys? It's The Walking David.
Hey, David. What's going on, buddy?
No, I'm not. I just had a question I wanted to propose to you guys. Let me just find it here on my phone.
Do it.
I know people are going to give me shit. Wasn't ready.
Hey, fuck you. Be ready, motherfucker. You know how it goes. No. I'm just trying to distract. Okay. I'm trying to fill in the time gap before you're ready.
We're slackers and procrastinators.
I was going to ask you, due to the new mark that Bran has, do you think that he'll either be able to warg the White King, or at least be able to read his mind or track the White Walker, since they can track him since he was touched? Do you think, since Bran is a warg, he could do the reverse?
Interesting. What do you think about that, Carmine? Do you think this sets up a multi-Lojack setting up on both sides? White Walker net, you think?
I agree with I think Joe said it before. I think Bran will come through the wall and back to Winterfell, and maybe Jon might use that to face off against the Night's King, considering he has one of the few weapons that can actually stand up against them, the Valyrian steel sword.
And his thought I had, if Bran can start manipulating all this shit in the past, then what's to stop Bran from just warging all the way the fuck back to when they plunge that dragon ice, the dragon glass, into the human's fucking chest and fucking kill everybody there. Warg into something, you know, to come and go.
Yeah, Joe, why can't Marty McFly?
That's why this whole time travel shit is bullshit. And, like, as soon as he starts being able to manipulate anything that's not, like, a White Walker touching him, which is all part of that same magic, like, it's just fucking weird. Like, it hurts my brain to start thinking about, even Einstein couldn't figure it out. Mm. Come on.
Yeah, Yahoo Saris couldn't do it, Joe. Are we going to riot tonight? Someone says, just like Harry Potter, two direwolves left. What the fuck? What the fuck, Hodor? Cold hands might guide Bran and Mira back to Apulia. That's what I said. Bran and the White King, Harry Potter, Voldemort, Harry's we have to ask ourselves why the Knight cares about Bran. Why does the Night's King care about Bran so much? Because he has power that could possibly stop him.
Absolutely.
Somehow.
Because he's an adorable boy.
Someone had asked the question if we think that I think David was asking if Bran could be powerful enough to warg the Night's King. I don't know about that. I don't know if he'd be that powerful. I think when George R. Martin was asked about if he could warg dragons, I think his response was, it's never happened before. There's no precedent for it. He didn't actually say no, but dragons are supposed to be as smart, if not smarter than humans in their own way. So that's why it's a little bit more difficult for Bran to warg with people, warg with creatures that have like their own free will.
Yeah,
it's a little bit more difficult.
Stronger.
But he did easily warg with young Willis there. But it's we always say that he warged Hodor.
Like that was fucking battle.
That takes some power. That takes some fucking power.
Right, and that's where you start thinking, maybe he, what if he's wargs into Jaime?
Yeah.
What if he wargs into other things in the past, like...
Into Jaime, interesting. Let's take area code 224. 224, what's going on? Yeah, that's you. Welcome to the show. What's going on?
Oh, no.
Okay. So, what do you think about, like, the White Walker, like, how he was created, like, because isn't it different in the books? Like, wasn't it like the 13th Lord Commander? Like, is it different in the books?
Let's go. Good question. Let's go over to Carmine for this one. What did you think of the scene about showing the children starting the whole White Walker thing? And what information, if anything, is in the books about that?
They really haven't touched a lot on the White Walkers in the books. We barely ever see them, or even, like we see them in the books, is what I mean. For example, like, in the books, Jon never goes to Hardhome. He just just sits at Castle Black and reads a letter. Oh, the mission at Hardhome didn't go so good. So, they include the White Walkers a lot more. I just want to know if that's true or not. I mean, I know the show is doing its own thing, but I want to know if that's George Martin's original intent for them.
Yeah.
Were they just a weapon of the Children of the Forest that just gone completely like kind of like Terminator, how Skynet goes against the humans?
Yeah, it's hard for me to believe that they would. It's hard for me to believe that they would do something, and maybe this is giving them too much credit and feeling like they have too much reverence to the material, that something this big, I feel like, has to come from the source material. I feel like this isn't, it smells of something that George would probably do, because it makes sense in a weird way. I would assume, and maybe I'm making a mistake, but I'd assume that this is the same in the books as in the show. But that's just my that's my instinct.
Yeah.
I do want to point out one little other moment that they have in this to add credence to Joe's battle point. Was this a sort of fuck you moment by Dan and Dave writing in the script tonight? The line "Winds of Winter" during the play section when one of the characters goes, it's Cersei's character in the play comes out and goes, "It's going to be the winds of winter." She actually says that line in the show. I don't know if that's just a kind of a digging in a little bit. That's a little fun right there.
Aren't the titles of the books in, like, it doesn't someone say A Feast for Crows? Somebody says, when you play the Game of Thrones, you win or die.
In almost every line, I think last season they say Dance with Dragons. I think the title of almost every book pops in every episode. So this is maybe, for people that are hoping that Winds of Winter comes out this year, maybe that was a good message that it was sending you, that, don't worry, it's coming, guys. Don't worry, it's coming. We've gone this far ultimately and not talked about that scene too. And before we get too far into go into a quick recap of everything, what did you got? I thought that was one of the scenes that gets lost in the mix, but that was one of my favorite scenes of the whole entire episode. The play and seeing that from Arya's perspective. What I did not like about the Arya stuff is I feel like they could have started the Arya scene with him giving her the poison. I don't think we needed another her getting her ass kicked by the weight.
The training montage?
Yeah, we didn't need that. Didn't we get through that last week? Wasn't that the whole point of last week, that she's made it through the training montage section? Then they could have just started that scene with Jaqen giving her the poison and telling her the whole situation for the play, or even starting it with her in the audience of the play. I don't feel like... And this is something I want to bring up that Carmine mentioned earlier. So far, we've only had one episode that's been over the hour time frame.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to dwell on this because, you know, I'm so, hey, everybody, you know, I'm like, I'm Kermit the Frog at the beginning of a show. Hey, everybody. But ultimately, these shorter episodes are kind of upsetting me a little bit, in the sense that I feel, you don't want to make the episode longer, but I don't think Sons of Anarchy was the best show in the world, but you know what I loved about watching that fucking show? The last season when Kurt Sutter stopped giving a shit, and every episode was a different time frame. It was like an hour and 35 minutes, an hour and 45 minutes, two and a half hours.
To be fair, most of those were like so Katie could have two songs.
Yeah,
we don't have to talk about that.
That's not the point. That's not my point. You're making evidence that's against my point. I don't want to hear that.
No, that is your point, because that's Kurt Sutter not giving a fuck.
Right.
And not making great material, but just throwing extra time to give.
You really think HBO would give a shit if they were like, yeah, every episode this season is going to be an hour and 15
minutes? No, they do not. I think HBO would be happy about it. Actually, I think HBO would be upset. They would tell them, no, you can't do that. We want you to cut them and make more episodes. Like probably. They're telling you to do in the first place.
Yeah. Probably, because they want this show to last forever.
They want more weeks of, right.
Oh, and I forgot penis warts. Yeah, we haven't talked about penis warts yet. Yeah, all the girls. Was this just a fuck you to the girls that are asking for more cock in the show? They show you a cock.
I hate to be that guy, but ladies, I understand you girls want, you know, naked equality, but the male body is really not as pretty as you think it is. I mean, it's really not.
Someone says penis warts go away. We learned something in this episode of Game of Thrones. Penis warts go away in 5 years, guys. So, anyone out there that has them,
let them hang.
Yeah, just let them hang for the next 5 years. You'll be good.
No big deal.
Yeah, fucking here. So when someone says, how does the Blackfish have an army when he can't even take River Run? He did take River Run. That's what we found out in this episode, that he was able to take back River Run. So
he's a legend.
He
rallied some of the remaining soldiers. Not all the Tully soldiers were killed in the Red Wedding. Some of them stayed behind. So you could just assume he rallied some of them.
Oh, someone says, I know who's responsible for that. I'm actually Pat. So I know who's responsible for the warts. It was the son of the herpes.
That's the sound of the herpes right there.
You're so clever.
Yeah, I gotta give the chat room credit for that one. I just steal half my lines from the live fucking chatter of the fucking awesome fucking folks saying some great stuff. Note to phrase: I only have 3 more years of penis warts. Awesome.
So speaking of this acting troupe, this woman that needs to die that Ari is supposedly gonna go kill.
Mm-hmm.
Now, did you get the impression that the body that Jaqen is cleaning is the body that was paid for, the life that was paid for this other woman to die?
Yeah, I didn't particularly get that impression, but I just thought it was just another body. But
it's like a monetary thing, like.
Curious. Interesting stuff. I love Arya's look though when she gives him she gives the waif this look like he's just like.
I am not you!
And she just like wants to kick her down. She's like, I have had enough of you. And she wants to fight her. The waif throws down her sword and still kicks Arya's ass anyway.
That's what I think they're establishing, that Arya is not really excelling at this being no one thing.
No.
She is still prideful. She is fighting for something.
Katie, it goes even further that I think a lot of people are going to talk about this because it was pretty obvious, but ultimately, too, we see how she's pretending, she's talking a big game about being no one, But ultimately, she can't be no one in the scene. She's enjoying the play, but once the Ned comes out, and once they start making fun of her daddy,
she remembers it all.
And it flashes her back to that moment of seeing him lose his head in a similar public sort of fashion. She's all Arya all the time.
Yep.
She cannot not be her.
And it's not fair. Jaqen even says it like we're all people who were nothing to begin with. We were slaves and peasants who nobody saw to begin with. So for us to be nobody, we were nobody. We are nobody. You were somebody. You have to shed it all to become nobody. That's very difficult.
Yeah. No, it was very fun, and I like that the play situation happened too. I liked getting to go there and interact in that situation and seeing all the old characters and finally seeing Sansa naked in an episode, even though it wasn't real Sansa.
I was gonna say you got your Sansa titties finally, Phil.
Yeah, I did. It was a long, hard road to get there, Joe. Very hard. Very hard.
But even like the director said, it was a pale comparison for the true Sansa.
She's not a good actress. She's very angry. So, ultimately, is there any other points that we didn't really hit upon in this episode? I think we basically talked about every single scene. We'll do a quick step up through the recap right now, and we'll take a few more calls along the way. And Sansa Titties 2016, someone says.
They called that actress back. What if she actually did audition for the Sansa role? And they were like, so we finally got a Sansa role for you.
So here we go. The episode opens up with Sansa in. Well, Sansa finds out Littlefinger's there, and then we get this scene. I'm going to play a couple of a little bit of this scene. Let's see Sansa and Littlefinger talk, and we already talked about all these scenes. Littlefinger and Sansa have their back and forth.
I just give Winterfell a fear the worst.
Is this David again calling in?
See you unharmed.
Pretty good. Let's actually do this a one for one here. Let's see how David does.
Hello.
Phil. There we go. Not bad. We get the real unharmed. Littlefinger. But I mean, ultimately, we talked about the scene. This scene starts. I love Sansa in this scene. Pushing it and really pushing it at Littlefinger, but yeah. I mean I think we kind of talked about this earlier. Carmine was saying this earlier as well. I think she's stupid. I personally think she's stupid for not taking the Veil Soldiers. Right? We're pretty stupid for not taking the Veil Soldiers, Carmine.
Yeah, I think she's pretty dumb. I mean, as long as Peter Baelish is in the picture, she has those soldiers. But if she has Brienne kill him, the Knights of the Vale will probably go back home and just, you know, chillax. She could use the soldiers to help them, you know, remove Ramsay from Winterfell and then, you know, kill off Peter Baelish or maybe manipulate Robin against Peter.
Mm-hmm. Here's the thing, though. We all know that she's not going to be able to play Peter Baelish. None of us believe that she's smart enough to do so.
He just has experience.
And so there is the old adage, keep your enemies close, your friends close and your enemies closer, right? Mm-hmm. But in this case, it might be good to keep Baelish away and not let him in even a little to gain this army. That you might want to, you know, figure out a way to manipulate Baelish in the future, but not take him now. Make him want it even more. Make him need to get in even more.
Make him desperate.
Make him a little bit more desperate. Keep him at bay from this. That might be a smarter move than to just take those troops right away.
Yeah.
Because we said, we're not sure. Like, if he's in, if you let that snake into the nest. You know, that it's going to lay eggs, and when those eggs hatch, those little fucking baby snakes are going to eat your chicklets too. So you don't let that viper in. Keep him at bay, make him want in, and then manipulate him in the future. That's probably the better.
Take Robin for yourself.
There you go.
Someone says, no, that's stupid, Joe. But
somebody says that. I mean,
No.
You know, I'm not saying I have the answers. I'm saying maybe that's a better play, but
good call, Joe. I agree 100%.
Right. Of course I was going to say that.
Because I'm right.
Because I'm right. Those people are geniuses right there. Those people are fucking geniuses. So we already kind of talked this scene to death. One last thing I just want to talk about that scene, Brienne. I love Brienne in this scene. Lady Sansa asked you a fucking question. You answer it now, Littlefinger.
She, like, grabs that fucking sword and steps forward, puffs her chest up.
Great stuff. I love Brienne in this episode.
I almost wish that she did say, fucking do it. Kill him. Fucking cut him down now.
I would have been okay with that. Off, maybe.
If she had said, like, you know, strike him down where he stands, cut his fucking tongue out, cut that lion face's tongue out of his mouth right this minute, I would have been okay with that. And to watch Brienne open his mouth and pull out his fucking tongue and snip it off would have been sweet.
Now, Carmine, do you think the only reason Littlefinger said that, like you can kill me if you want to kill me, because he had a read on Sansa, he knew she would never actually do it?
Absolutely. Yeah.
He's not dead.
Yeah, yet. Of course. He knew she wouldn't do it. Sansa still owes him one, and she let him go because he did rescue her from King's Landing. So he let her go because she let her him go because of that. But next time, there isn't going to be no next time. She will sick Brienne on him or whoever else is there, and Peter will die.
Yeah.
So you think, or just your speculation now would be that Peter dies from Sansa's hand some way.
I hope that doesn't happen until the very last season, because I really want to see what all his planning has come to. I mean, there has to be a conclusion to it. It'd be fucking stupid. Like I said last week, it'd be kind of dumb if, you know, he's about to explain all his plans and he falls down the fucking stairs. It's kind of dumb. I really hope we get, like, the big reveal as to what he's really planning.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, me too. I agree with that 100%. Timo says, Arya lied saying the actress is the only one to drink the wine, but wasn't the Tyrion actor drinking the wine as well? She was drinking rum. Basically what happened in that scene, I had to watch it a couple times to get exactly what was going on. The Tyrion guy offered her wine. She said, no, I only drink rum, or I'm a rum girl. If you want to hook up with me, you're going to have to learn quickly. I'm a rum girl. So,
she had her own bottle of rum.
She had her own bottle of rum, so she didn't actually share the wine that the Tyrion dude split, and no one else drank the rum. So, Arya was right in that situation. Yeah. So, our next scene, we kind of talked about this before. Arya with the waif going back and forth with her, with all this sort of shit.
You'll never be one of us, Lady Stark.
She has a point.
Mm-hmm. All this sort of shit. Wow. She has
none of the first faceless men were born to lords and ladies.
This is what I want.
They began as slaves in the mines of Illyria.
Who was the first?
He was no one.
Duh. Like, really? Of course you're still not. You're still Arya Stark if you had to ask that fucking question.
In exchange for their service. Many served. Many more gifts were given. Soon all the masters and overseers were gone. And the faceless men fled.
Where did they go?
It doesn't matter where they fucking went.
They founded the free city of Braavos and built this house. These were the places they were in life.
Now, you guys that are a little bit more books, is this story told in the books at all, Carmine? Is this story canon to the books about the foundation of the Faceless Men?
I don't remember anything like that, but I do know there's like a theory floating around that the Faceless Men caused the doom of Valyria and destroyed that entire civilization, and then they just left before all that went down and formed Braavos. There is that theory floating around, but I don't remember anything like that happening.
Yeah, I do remember there was slaves did find, it was escaped slaves from somewhere that found Braavos. That's why it was one of the free cities. It was like one of the first free cities or something like that. And I have that recollection from the books, but, you know, the chat's going to tell us for sure.
Yeah, they'll tell us for sure. Arya, die now. I agree. Oh, my gosh. Arya, the waif is lame, someone says. Fucking lame. Will we ever see more of Braavos? I'm curious about, I know Joe and Carmine, I think, are both passionate about this as well, that we haven't seen enough of Braavos. Joe, what do you think about that? And then we'll go over to Carmine.
I think that's huge. That was a big thing. She's all up and about in Braavos, like, fucking doing this, doing that, running around with cats.
In that Braavos
and,
shit. Like,
just all this stuff that they've left out, and they've kind of put way too much emphasis on this, you know, ninja master training shit that she hasn't seemed to excel very much at.
Yeah. And Carmine, do you think they'll ever explore Braavos anymore, or do you think what we have is what we'll get at this point?
I'll say this before I have to get off. We see in the trailer that she's running around doing all kinds of parkour. So I think we may get that this time around. We may get to finally see all of Braavos when she's running around. She's running from someone. I have no idea who.
I hope she kills. I hope she blows the frickin' house in black and white up and then gets her ass on a fucking ship and goes back to Westeros.
Well, to that I say, they did play Sophie Turner and Maisie Williams did play Two Truths and One Lie. And one of the three things that Maisie Williams said, who plays Arya, is that two truths, one lie. So Arya goes back to Westeros. Arya kills three people on her list, and Arya was in the trailer more times than you realize. You just didn't see her. So, like, maybe Arya takes a bunch of faces on her own and starts using them, or I have no idea. But one of those is a lie. The other two are true. So you're right. Maybe she does probably go to Westeros at the end.
Well, Carmine, we'd like to thank you as always for joining us. Fucking thank you so much, buddy, for
checking in with us,
even a little longer than I think you wanted to. So we kept you with us for a little bit. So thank you, buddy, and we'll definitely check in with you even more during the year. here. So everyone make sure if you haven't already subscribed to Red Team Review. Check out Carmine's review. Will probably be coming out sometime in the next 24 hours or something like that. So, Carmine, thank you. Huge thanks.
Oh, thank you, fella. I'll see you guys next time.
Excellent. See you next time, buddy.
Talk Have a good one, guys.
Carmine from Red Team is taken off. And again, huge thanks to him. And I've said this before, huge thanks to Devin, who fucking funny bastard, and love talking some Game of Thrones with Devin as well. And thank you to everyone that has come over here from his channel as well, that have come over and joining us. And if you're enjoying this and you like what we're doing, please hit that subscribe button and please hit that like button. It means so much to us as we go. So let's continue, everybody. Let's continue. No Sansa titties, sad face in there in the comments. Phil, can we have a quick moment of celebration that we have four straight episodes with no Dorne? Yes! I will toast to that shit. Toast to everybody in that shit. As I have my Game of Thrones glass here. Toast to no fucking door.
Cheers.
Cheers. Mm-hmm. Says that was emotional. That was an emotional scene. Love you, Phil, Joe, and Katie. Love all of you guys. And thank you, everyone, that has been tuning in. We're going to zip through the rest of this episode and get through the last recap. And then we're going to get back to the phone lines and take anyone that's on the line waiting for hold. And as always, we do a feedback show later in the week. And if you didn't get your comment or your question in, make sure you leave a voicemail, 781-990-8509, or a text message. And any of the people that are leaving messages right now, we'll get to those on the feedback show, which will either be on Wednesday or Thursday. So probably this week on Wednesday at like 2:30-ish. So Arya's training, blah, 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 more Arya training. So the next scene is our theater scene. And I kind of want to play this because I enjoyed this so much.
Well, it's good to see her dressed as Arya again.
It is awesome to see that. And I just love this scene. So let's play a little of the audio from the play.
Murdered by a boar. The great big hairy hole. He dug in his tusks and dug out my guts. And soon I am no more.
Come, father, in bed you must lie. I love you, father. Please don't die.
Shut up, you swine. Cersei, more wine.
I feel the winds of winter as they lick across the land.
There was the winds of winter land.
And see, yes. even right there, they basically accused Joffrey of killing him because he says he was killed by a boar, and then he calls his son a swine.
Ooh.
Yep, fine wine. This is a great scene back and forth. Arya watches it. She thinks it's funny until Ned shows back up, where she gets kind of emotional by it. We go backstage afterwards, and we get fake Joffrey with two warts on his cock, and we get some cock, and 5-6 years of the genital warts go away. So in case you care, that's when they go away. We get to see the girl that Arya needs to kill, the actress, and we kind of talked about that scene a second ago with the actor that plays Tyrion that looks a lot like Judd Hirsch. I don't know if anyone else thought that, and anyone who knows who Judd Hirsch is, Riga from Taxi, next time you see the Tyrion, he kind of looks like Judd Hirsch to me. Joe's giving me a look like, no fucking way, but...
I'm trying to, like, picture him, but...
Imagine it. Joe, do you know what I forgot?
What's that?
I forgot this. I forgot our recap. 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 Sorry, I forgot to go into the recap. Yeah, there we go. So
it's official.
It's official.
It's, new. It's only the third time that it's gone. So
It's true. It's true. We need to recap. Steven, hey, Timo, and huge thank you to Timo and all the FOPs that are in the chat right now. Tell them to like the video, subscribe. You guys are the best. If we keep growing, it's only thanks to the hard work that all of you guys do. And anyone, like with Carmine, with Devin, it was people that watch our channel that fucking share the channel out there. So if anyone out there wants to share us and help us grow, it fucking means a lot to us, and we'll be eternally thankful. So thank you to all of you guys that have shared our channel and continue to. So it means so much. Okay, enough of that crap.
And no, so
definitely. Enough of that crap, Joe. Enough of that crap. No more.
No, I was gonna read one of the comments.
Do it. Read it. Read it.
No Jews in Westeros. I was gonna say no, man. They're Bravos running shit.
So a girl wants
so to be bad, I know.
Joseph.
Joseph.
Oh well.
Joe. What? Oh my gosh. There's no offensive language on this show, Joe.
The faceless men behind the scenes.
Lady Crane is the only one who drinks it. If a girl could use one of the faces from the hall.
A girl is not.
I actually agree with what John says in the chat. Don't share or like this video. Definitely don't.
She's a good actress.
The man has heard.
Seems like a decent woman.
Yeah.
Does death only come for the wicked and leave the decent behind?
So back, they have a little back and forth right there, which is very interesting that they have an interesting back and forth. And Arya says it's a younger girl. She kind of makes it. And the most important thing is, have you decided if you want to face the many-faced god? He asks her at the end. And she says, yes. And he goes, well, servants don't ask fucking questions. Shut up and listen, girl. And do it. Do it, Sammy. I see you. Give me the important question. Oh, here we go. And thank you, Morning. You're awesome. I was checking out some of your videos. If you haven't, check out Morning's videos. There's very positive energy. Lots of positive energy. Chuck, are you crazy? Faceless Men is setting Arya up for a fail. I agree with that, Goat. Mm-hmm. Does Theon still have sex? With himself? Maybe? Maybe some butt stuff?
Yeah, that was definitely a big test for Arya to send her where to, like, he definitely knows that play is all about insulting her family
exactly
and shit.
What he's doing. Yeah.
So I think it's the last test, and I think she's gonna try to play it like she passes it.
Yep.
Or end up not.
No, I'm with you on that one, Joe. So then we go off to our first Blood Raven and Bran scene of the night. This is where we see that the man becomes that they turn the man into the White Walker, who is the actor that they. For whatever it's worth, I don't know if this means anything, but the actor that was playing the human that got stabbed with the dagger to turn into the White Walker was the same actor that the newer actor that plays the Night's King. So I don't know if that's supposed to be the Night's King, and he was born at that moment in the show, or what. I just know it's the same actor, and it's just worth mentioning that. So then when Bran comes out of all that, he goes, Leaf, what the fuck, Leaf? What the fuck you doing? Bran finds out about the White Walkers. Let's play a little audio of that one.
It was you.
You did it.
You made the White Walkers.
What the fuck?
We were at war. We were being slaughtered. Our sacred trees cut down.
Yeah, exactly, Seb. Theon can still enjoy anal pleasures.
We needed to defend ourselves.
From whom?
From you. From men.
So they create the White Walkers, and the White Walkers start slaughtering the humans. Yep. And the humans change their mind about whether or not the children are bad because they don't see them as being with the White Walkers. So they kind of try to make peace and make an alliance, and the White Walkers are like, what the fuck?
Nope.
There is no peace. You created us to kill them all. You can't be peaceful with them. Now you're our enemy too, and we're going to come kill you. Yeah. And so the children and the humans basically band together and fight off the White Walkers.
Yep. You know I do, Deb. The waif could be caboodled by Needle very, very soon. Children of the Forest become Ferngully. Fuck. Arya stops giving a fuck. Fucking crazy shit. So then we get to see the actor same as Night's King, yada yada yada. Children of the Forest, stay away from them, Bran, they're evil. So then we get our Kingsmoot. I think there's not much else to say about the Kingsmoot that we didn't already say. We kind of got way into that in our intro. So Euron is basically cockless wonder with him here. It's a lot of fun back and forth with Euron and Theon.
We speak in the presence of the drowned god. In his name, we gather today to choose a new king as our leader.
New king?
Who makes a claim?
King of the fucking something. King of the something. So that is that. And generally speaking, I'm sort of yada-yadding through this because we talked a lot of this stuff in depth in our opening. So we don't need to, like, bemuse this stuff. The King's Moot, we kind of already talked about all of that. So then we go to Daenerys. We didn't really talk about the scene in detail. So he's very conflicted talking to Dario and Jorah. She says, I banished you twice, and you came back twice. I can't keep doing this. And this scene right here, I'm going to play it here. This scene really made me emotional.
I banished you twice. You came back.
Why not just call it the Seastone Chair? Why they call it the Saul Sword? I don't know. That's one of those changes I don't get. There's certain changes that they make that It's like, why change that? You didn't need to change that. Like calling Hodor Willis instead of Walda. It's just, there's certain little things that just, you're like, did they do that just because they don't want another Walda Frey? They do that because they thought that lines, that Seastone chair sounded a little bit too complex. So they just wanted to say Salt Throne because salty and the Greyjoys are salty. I don't know. It's one of those weird changes that I don't understand why they changed it. They didn't have to do that.
You saved my life.
But some people, I really like the Danny scenes here.
So I can't take you back, and I can't send you away.
I cried my eyes off here. Like,
you must send me away.
The last two episodes, you know why I cried my eyes off, guys? Really? Because I enjoyed the Daenerys scenes the last two episodes, and I was like hate fucking myself there. I was like, oh my gosh, I enjoyed the Danny scenes a lot. Oh my God, what's wrong with me?
Yeah, what
happened when it goes far enough? I'll end things before that.
Really emotional stuff. The emotion that they're both playing this, the Jorah and the actor that plays Jorah and Emile Clarke are playing here. It's just really high end stuff. And the
Tyrion Lannister was right.
Right here it is.
Tyrion Lannister's just always
love right. You.
Yeah. Shouldn't all sentences in Westeros start that way?
I'll always love you.
Oh. Oh. Oh.
No, he said to believe. I will always believe you.
To believe. It gets really emotional there, and then it gets into that whole thing we talked about earlier.
You two go not walk away from your queen.
Don't walk away.
Jorah from the Andal.
Don't.
Jorah the Andal.
He might not become a full Stony.
He's done for, Joe.
And you pledged yourself.
What's your name, wasn't?
There's you swore to obey my commands for the rest of your life.
It just stops sometimes, and nobody knows
why.
I
command you to find the cure.
Everything I do it for Daenerys.
So,
here's
a question, Phil.
Yep.
Does he do it? Does he fulfill her last command?
Yes, because she commanded it.
Katie, just to go in to springboard off your point, I think they wouldn't have put that in there if he doesn't somehow recover from it.
Agreed.
And if he finds the cure, is then she going to go spray down all Valyria with the cure and retake her?
See, I thought, yes, Joe, I think she might do that. I ultimately thought that the cure would be Dragon's Fire for some reason. I thought that she would be like, okay, fucking Drogon, come
burn
here.
Burn off the scales.
Burn that shit off right now.
Yeah.
Ooh. So, but ultimately, I think you might be onto something, Joe, by accident. I think you kind of have... that might be because some part of me feels like the end of the series is going to be Danny returning to Valyria and sort of.
So this was all just a big outbreak film.
Yeah, maybe, guys.
28 centuries later.
Jorah actor is so handsome. Yeah, it makes it weird because in the books, I did not imagine Jorah being as good looking as the actor that plays.
I didn't.
I always thought he was weird. Okay, so then
I was introduced with Jorah first because I saw season one first, so it was always in my mind as Jorah. It was Jorah.
So then we get into our Tyrion moment of the episode, which is really fun stuff. We see the small council of Dany. Let me get to this. This is the type of stuff that it's easier to play than talk about it. So here we go. Let's play.
In the last fortnight since our pact with the
PR firm,
how many killings have been carried out by the Sons of the Harpy?
None.
And how many masters have been butchered by the Freemen?
None.
Oof. That was the day of the pact. Since then, nothing.
Which, so it's safe to say that a fragile piece.
Which eventually leads
Tyrion
to this scene.
Jorun. About the extent of my Valyrian.
And this is the whole Red Woman thing. I love how this sets up.
Everything is.
Oh, it's great. Yeah.
And here we go. Let's get into
the
heart
is
of this,
the Lord's will.
This whole exchange. Well,
but men and women make mistakes. Even honest servants of the Lord.
And you, an honest servant of the Lord? Why should I trust
Jacob.
To know any more than the priestess who counseled Stannis?
My friend has a healthy skepticism of religion.
Don't mind him.
Don't mind him. You're souring the plan. Shut the fuck up.
He's nudging him from behind.
I don't believe in this shit either, Varys. I don't believe in this fucking shit either, but we need her fucking on our side.
Varys just can't help himself.
No, he can't. I couldn't either, though. Ultimately, I'd be like, this is full of shit.
My friend has a healthy skepticism of religion. We are all loyal supporters of the Queen.
The Queen! Focus on the Queen!
Yeah, focus on the positive. Focus on the positive here.
Everyone is what they are and where they are.
Fuck you! I hate that shit. Everything happens for a reason. Everything happens for a reason.
Like what happened to you, Lord Virus, when you were a child.
What?
Not for your
YouTube. But it's not a secret that something happened to him as a child.
Huh? Right, right. I know. But the details about the voice and stuff, Joe, it gets a kind of detailed.
What the? Oh, yeah. She's creepy. What,
you want to
still so much.
You want to know how I got my scars, kids? You want to know how I got my scars? You want to know how I got these fucking, you want to know what the voice says? How many people? Raise your hand in the chat if you want to know what the fucking voice said. I want to know what the fucking
voice said. I want to know. I want to know.
Someone says she is gorgeous, though. Yeah, she is fucking gorgeous. I actually find this actress more attractive than Mel, but I'm more of a fan personally, but from just a superficial level. But I think it's interesting. She points out in this scene that I'm the hot shit of the Red Gods. So individual Red Priestesses might be wrong, but you know, you're looking at the king shit here. Do we think she's glamoring too? That's an interesting question to Joe and Kate.
You think
she's glamoring as well?
Yes.
The voice said, that's a pretty big penis for a 5-year-old.
Well, here's the thing. Varys is onto something. You know, they're going to, you know, Stannis was the true lord, and this one's the true lord, and that one's the true lord, and whatever serves your purpose is what you're going to say. And they're... I just find it interesting that, you know, I'm sure they get word of shit that's going down in Westeros. Mm-hmm. They have a network of information getting. So I'm sure they've heard about Cersei's fucking walk of shame. And why then would you feel like a church is a good thing to get involved and use as your PR firm?
I don't know if they know about that, to be honest, Joe. So let's take a couple calls. Right. Let's take a couple calls here. Area code 334. Welcome to the show. What's going on?
Hi, Joe.
Yes. You're on the air. We ended up the call got dropped. I did not hang up on that call. We ended up losing the call. Definitely call back in. They seem to know you, Joe. There was a little person. Yeah. So area code 413. You're on the air. Area code 413.
Hello, Phil, Joe, and Katie. Great recap show as usual. Quick question.
Wait. Before you talk, is this the fucking awesome human being, one of my favorite individuals, Al, Red Sox fan?
Could be. Yes, it is, Phil.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Hey, on a quick question. On the Dothraki, hopefully I pronounced that right.
Close enough.
I don't really think that they're that good of a fighting force because, I mean, I think Dany put it the right way when she said, you've been beating up a bunch of sheep herders. When they go to the big city states, those rulers just pay them off because they're like, it's easier just to pay them off than kill them.
Yeah,
you know? They don't even pay them off.
I think they're just like cannon fodder if they go fight a modern Western army. You know, they're like cavalry. I was just curious what Joe and Katie and yourself think of it, Phil. And thank you very much for doing this show. It's really fun to watch and participate. And I think everyone has a great time. The most fan-friendly show and recap show. Take care, guys.
Good night. The best, Al Red Sox. Joe, what do you have to say about what Al had to say?
I think cavalry is an amazing weapon. Heavy cavalry, better. But there's many fighting forces, Mongols and Hungs, Huns, and that have been known to be horseback fighting forces that have done traditionally very well. And then there's some that, you know, don't
do as well. Phil, you do that.
I think a big problem is they're all going to be freaked out getting over the sea to begin with. Mm. And then when they do get there, they will be able to, it's going to be tough fighting against some of the heavy armor,
It'll be different terrain, different.
In fairness, they will have dragons on their sides. And you're right, Flair. I do that a lot. And King's Boot reminded me of how California primary might go. Colin never saw the last samurai of the cavalry. Bad and hearted. That's a Hodor-sized bong. Yes, Hodor-sized bong. I like that. So let's take a couple more calls before we head into back into the recap here. Area code 214. You're on the air. What's going on?
Hey, guys. What's up? It's KLC.
Hey, buddy. What's going on, KLC?
All right. I got two things to say and then one question. So, first of all, I want to say, I don't know if any of you guys have ever watched the show Avatar The Last Airbender, but for the play scene in this episode, it really reminded me of the episode The Ember Island Players. It was an episode where the main characters just watched a play of themselves. It was pretty hilarious. So, I thought that was a cool connection. And then I want to say I probably won't be able to join you guys for the next few weeks because my HBO Go is expiring.
Oh, bummer, buddy.
Oh, no.
So I'm not saying I pirate, but I have a buddy who pirates in it. But you guys, anyone has a good place to do that, hit me up in the Discord chat. And my last thing is, what do you guys think that they're going to do with the direwolves? Because so far, it just kind of seems like the direwolves have been a dead end fly. Half of them are dead now. So we think they can go on the TV show without being a complete waste of time.
Great stuff as always, KLC. Talk to you very soon, my friend. I think with the direwolves, they're trying to, unfortunately, limit them as much as possible, and kind of just seems like they're trying to rub off direwolves. I don't see them getting rid of
Ghost. Ghost is Azor Ahai.
Yeah, Ghost is Azor Ahai, Katie. I agree.
Damn it.
So let's take a couple more calls. In about 4 minutes, we're going to need to reset the phone calls and start again. So if you're in hold, you may need to call right back in. But we'll take two more calls right here, and then we'll get back into our recap. Area code 715. You're on the air. What's going on, 715?
Hey, you Jiggalo and it's Madcap Man here. What's going on, guys?
Oh, the Yep Professing Elephant with tiny eyes, buddy. Let us have it.
All right. Here's one out there. No Umbers this week. I'll have pity on us all. you guys had mentioned how, it's nice seeing Arya as Arya again. What if they're having her kill the rest of the people that are left on her list so she can truly become no one?
Ooh,
what do you think?
I like that. Good, very good question, my friend. I think that you might be onto something. I think that maybe they're using her to fuel their own god's power in that sense of that she has a list. She wants to kill people. She's already showed a predilection at a young age for wanting to kill and murder. She has a list of people she wants to die. So if you can kind of hijack that list, put your clamps into that list, you can get what you need from what she already has to do. So it's kind of killing two birds with one stone. So perhaps some people on her list are on that the many-faced god needs to take down too. So it's comparative. They both have similar goals at times. So I think the House of Black and White respects the fact that Arya makes a list and does it in a very organized way. In some way, she has a list. She has these things to do. It's all about murder. It's revenge leads her. So let's take one more call now before we get back to our recap. Area code 716. What's going on?
Hey guys, it's Brad.
Hey, Brad.
I just finished the episode. Pretty crazy. So I guess a good theme here. I wanted to call in about Arya. So going back to Jaqen, why was he in Westeros in the first place? So I'm assuming he was on some assignment of some sort, right?
Good question.
It's a good question.
At some point, Arya, I mean, we all have to assume she's going back to Westeros at some point. So I'm thinking that I'm trying to think of what interesting situation she'll be kind of thrust into.
Yeah.
So what do you guys think about that? And
I know exactly why he was in Westeros.
Is anyone else just kind of annoyed with the whole no one thing? Because it's kind of getting annoying at this point, because last season we had that huge scene where they kind of told her to just give everything away, but she couldn't give away Neil.
90 seconds.
Those rocks.
Good.
So she's still Arya. Yeah. And whenever she leaves Bravo, she's still taking Neil with her.
Yes.
Because Neil represents John, who gave it to her. It represents Ed, who embraced her for who she was and let her sword training and all that stuff. So unless she leaves Bravos and she forgets about Needle, then I would believe that she's no one.
Mm-hmm. 60 seconds.
This episode where she basically had to relive her dad dying, I'm not buying it. So my question is, where do you guys think she comes into play in Westeros down the line?
Good question. Sorry, you ended up getting cut off because we're running out of time here. Ultimately, I think that one of the people on her list is going to be a part of Jaqen's plan, and he's going to send her to kill one of the people on the list. That's what I think about him. Joe?
Jaqen was in Westeros.
Yes. Why?
Why?
Yes.
To train Arya in water dancing.
Shut up. I'm not. You're so full of ass.
Well, we haven't seen.
No,
I don't like Ariel Pharrell, dude. Wow. He's not Ariel Pharrell.
Hold on. What? Wait. Why not? Wait. He just shows up in the cage, right? If he is a faceless man, if Cyril Pharrell is a faceless
he's
man.
He's not.
Why wouldn't he be?
He's not, because that's the problem with not seeing more Bravos. He's a completely different part of Bravos.
He's one of the water dancers.
It has nothing to do with it. You're grasping. That's one of the theories that kind of doesn't bother me. I'd want it. I mean, I wouldn't be upset if it was true, but I just think you're so full of shit there. I mean, I don't think you're full of shit. I mean, I think you really believe it, but I don't believe that even for a fucking second. I don't believe it for a fucking second. So
true, I tell you.
We didn't see him die on screen. Cereal forever. People in the chat are always on Europe. Let's start a rant. People love our rant, Joe. Cereal.
So, but you know, so if it, you know, there
you're
you
full of shit, Joe. Fuck you.
Why? Come on.
Fuck you.
Explain to me why not.
No, you explain to me why. I'm trying to get you to rant, Joe. Come on.
Listen, I think it ties in. If we haven't seen any of the other water dancers in Bravos, which is something that Arya was keen on, on seeing, on maybe be getting to be more of a part of.
Yes. And
it just seems,
you know what, Joe?
I don't know. It's a possibility, and I'm not gonna give up hope on it. I'm not gonna sink. You know, I'm not gonna put money on it.
No,
but
it's one of the many possibilities.
I've been kind of waiting for that too. Thanks, Tim.
I saw Tim in the chat. That's why.
Hashtag
Tim Gersh. Hashtag Tim Gersh. I saw Tim Gersh in the live chat. Well, great to see. Joe Rant 2016. People, someone's gonna put in the chat room, Phil, why'd you shut Joe up? Why are you always talking over Joe? But you know why I'm always talking over Joe? This is the point. This is the point of everything. This is why it is. This is why.
And I think the caller is absolutely right that she's not going to – she is still Arya Stark. That was one of the important reasons that she was dressed as Arya Stark during this play.
No, you can keep
And I think that – what's his name, Jaqen? Knows a little too much, knows what buttons they were going to push.
Oh, yeah.
In this play.
Absolutely.
I don't know. I'm just
– he's working her for something.
No, I'm with you on that. I mean, I don't think I just don't think the things are mutually exclusive. I don't think just because he's working her means he's Cyril Pharrell. I just don't equate both situations. I mean, I think it's interesting what you're saying. I think it's like an interesting element, but I don't buy it 100%.
Yeah.
No, I don't buy it 100% either.
It's a nice idea.
I'm a fan of Cereos, so.
Someone says Joe gets no respect. Joe's the Rodney Dangerfield of this show.
Joe Dangerfield,
He's Joey Dangerfield on this show. Joe
Dangerfield.
Maybe he's Cereal's brother, someone says in the chat. Arya Stark is the new Daredevil, Tyrion's losing his edge. Joe gets no respect. He died in the books, I'm pretty sure. And let's
your important instructions.
Push.
Since it appears.
Okay, so we're getting back into that. So our next scene is we see the Crow and Bran laying down, wasting time. And Bran sees Bloodraven. He's sniffing at him. He throws a rock at him to see if he's you awake, Bloodraven. So Bran decides to do some searching in the Weirwood Net himself. He gets in there gets in there, starts walking through the snow, eventually sees an army of whites that's just really crazy, and he starts doing like a 180 and as he comes around, you know what's coming because you saw it in the trailer, you know it's coming here, and you saw it in the preview for next week too. He comes around after making eye contact with the Night's King. The Night's King's standing right there, grabs him, puts his arm on him, and Bran starts freaking the fuck out when he comes back.
Yeah.
He's like, fuck, what the fuck's going on here? I'm trying to find I did have an audio of this somewhere, but whatever. He starts freaking out about all of this. And he turns around, he goes, Night's King touched me, he fucking touched me. And Bloodraven goes, yeah, he touched you. Your mark's on him. You're fucked now. You fucked us all. And Bran says, I'm really, really sorry. And Bloodraven's like, fuck you, you're sorry? You're not sorry. The White Walkers are coming to kill us all, you fucking shit.
Oh, you will be sorry.
He got his stank on you. And they're like, leave us now, get the fuck out of here. Leaf is super scared, and Mara gets her shit together. But
nope, time for another vision.
And Bran keeps apologizing. No, that's not yet, though. And Hodor says, Hodor, the time has come for you to become me. And am I ready? No, you're not ready. So then we go to our John.
No, and then his eyes flash right there.
They flash, but we don't go into that dream until the next
one. But that's just it. That means he's going into another vision, or he's warging or some shit like that. So it's like, it's time for you to, we need to get you out of here. They're coming. And then boom, like down into a fucking trance where he stays.
Through.
Right. It was like, what?
And then we end up kicking into this scene, the John Arya Davos super scene here that happens. And I'm going to just play this because
it's made it myself. Do you like it?
Oh no, sorry. That's John. That's John and Sansa in a second. Where is that fucking scene? Sansa, small council. Here it is.
We can't defend the north from the Walkers and the south from the Boltons. If we want to survive, we need Winterfell. And to take Winterfell, we need more men.
Someone says Bloodraven was uploading everything to Bran. So Bran has left three trees. Does this mean he won't get any more Green Seer visions? What about the scene in the trailer? It looks like Jaime killing the Mad King. It definitely does look like we're seeing a flashback of Jaime killing the Mad King. And I think Bran will still have his Green Seer powers. I think as long as there's trees out there, he'll have his powers.
From the Starks and the Boltons, the most powerful houses in the north, the Umbers, the Karstarks, and the Manderleys. The Umbers and the Karstarks have already declared for the Boltons, so we're not doing so well there.
The Umbers gave Rickon
blood. This is a great scene in here. I just want to get to Timo with a quick question. I understand why they killed Summer and Hodor in the same episode. They want to distract people from being upset over another direwolf, so they kill Hodor in a very sad way that people will talk about Hodor, not Summer. So is it a slick way of killing the direwolf, and everyone's talking about Hodor?
My enemy. Yeah. But the Karstarks declared for Ramsay without knowing they had another choice.
Oh, I beg your pardon, my lady, but they know that a Stark ahead of their father.
I'm going to play most of this scene because I think this is a really great scene, Joe. But ultimately, what do you make? We talked a little bit about this earlier, but what do you make of John's expressions through this whole scene while Sansa's talking?
I thought he was scared for Sansa.
Scared for
Sansa. Herself in the fight. Scared. I don't think he felt slighted by her. Because I felt like she was sticking up for him. Like, they'll respect him because I'm here and I call him brother. I'm a Stark, so he's a fucking Stark. That's how I took it.
Joe, can you agree with that? You're nodding as well. Summer's just hanging out with Shaggy Dog. Bran clearly can get visions by himself, so we'll get a Tower of Joy episode 2. Yeah. I was hoping he was going to go to the Tower of Joy as well.
Together they equal all the others. We can start small and build.
The North remembers.
Oh, yes. Whoa. The North remembers. Can I hear that again and make myself feel good? The North remembers, motherfucker. Yeah.
And that's kind of why I'm holding up hope for the Umbers to turn still, on the, like, to be like, you know, we can't let these people.
We'll still risk everything for it. No, I mean, White Harbor.
Sorry, Joe. I'm kind of hoping the same thing as well. But I'm sort of starting to lose hope about that, especially with what she says about the Umbers and the scene.
To Ramsay's own door.
I don't doubt it. John doesn't have the Stark name.
No, but I do.
What'd you say? What'd you say? We talked
about John is every bit as much Ned Stark's son as Ramsay is.
And then he plays it. I mean, we get into this scene. We already kind of talked all about this as well. And I'm just going to finish this scene.
Bruce Bolton.
No, he's not.
There are also the Tullys. They're not Northern, but they will back us against the Boltons without question.
I didn't know the Tullys still had an army.
My uncle, the Blackfish, has reformed it and retaken River Run.
How'd you know that?
Ramsay received a raven before I escaped Winterfell.
Liar!
Oh, Sansa.
Yeah. Good. Blackfish is a legend. His support will mean a great deal. Stark, Tully, a few more houses. It will start to look like a winning side.
So that is the scene right there with the two of them. And then it eventually leads into the Sansa and Brienne scene, which is very funny as well.
I've sworn to protect you, my lady.
You heard them. We need more men. And my uncle has an army.
We can send the Blackfish a raven.
We can't risk Ramsay intercepting. It has to be you. Ride for Riverrun. My uncle will talk to you, and you'll know how to talk.
And you think this is sending... You think
I don't like leaving you here alone.
You think sending Brienne off is a mistake, Joe?
Absolutely.
Very interesting stuff.
It makes me nervous.
So Brienne and Sansa have a talk. Sansa is wants to go to River End to find Blackfish, or send Brienne to get Blackfish. Brienne,
you said it yourself. That Peter has 40,000 men. So even if Jon and his army of what, 3,000 was it? 5,000?
2,000.
2,000 decide to march to go down south. They have to pass Winterfell and or Peter Baelish's frickin' army of 40,000 Eyries. Like it's asking to be...
You don't need to... You don't need to
and,
so,
and then sending Brienne, like, that's like... Who's not going to notice this woman traveling south with Podrick?
Yeah, no, good point. From Ehrlich and Timo, rest in peace to Summer. He was born in the North. Who could forget the time he served for Bran from the assassin, saved Bran from the assassin, or when he and Shaggy Dog saved Jon from the Wildlings, or when he took out the Whites outside the Weirwood Tree. He's one of the best and most loyal of all the direwolves. Now his watch has ended and should never see his like again. And Timo, you never have to apologize. Keep it coming as much as you want, Timo. So here we go. Let's go over to here. I'm sorry. I'm having a little trouble with the Discord. It's sort of screwing up for me. I'm not necessarily being able to get in there all the time. I can't stick my thing in there, everybody. Does anyone remember the merman pin at the Red Wedding? No, I do not apt. Armies on the show are not as big as in the books. Great point, Bruce. That is very, very true. So then we get the...
Tim had a good point. Have we ever known Littlefinger to be anything but full of shit? So by him letting... He has a reason for having told Sansa that, right? He has a reason for letting that... May I just say one last thing? You know, come on.
Yep. I also want to point out that Brienne kind of shit-talks everyone. She shit-talks Jon, and she's like, yeah, Jon seems nice.
Jon, not him.
He seems
trustworthy. A bit brooding, perhaps. I suppose it's understandable, considering.
Yeah.
The
others, though.
Considering he came back to life, you know, you guys are handling this pretty easy.
She does. She likes her people study,
I guess.
Davos and the Ridge Woman helped a man murder his own brother with blood magic. And when Stannis paid for his crime, where were they?
Yeah.
Already out looking for a leader with better prospects.
Mm-hmm.
And that wildling fellow with a beard.
Hey, hello. Lay off Tormund as he eye fucks her when they get outside. She's looking weird.
Oh,
Ed and Jon say their goodbyes after Sansa and Jon exchange. We see Sansa in her new dress, the one we see in the trailer that she sewed herself. We see in the original scene. She also sewed a little Ned Stark coat thing for Jon.
Sweet.
The pet of Jon, and he's very thankful of her. Anytime he says the word Sansa, it sounds weird to me because I've never heard those words out of his mouth before. So it's very interesting to hear it. Excuse me. So they go a very heartfelt back and forth between the two of them as Team Jon Snow and Sansa are on their way out to gather the houses. They all leave the wall, which Ed is left there alone with like 20 watch guys, and says, yeah, we're kind of fucked. We already talked about the Jon and him's exchange when they talk about the wall coming down. So that is that scene. And then we get back to our finish that I think that I've been avoiding getting into because it's very emotional. So we go back to the cave, and Bran and the Three-Eyed Raven are doing their thing. Mare's talking to Hodor about how they can go home and get somewhere, not in a cave, and get some eggs. Hodor likes this, and he says, Hodor.
Oh, yeah.
Mare gets a weird vibe for some reason. She heads outside to the opening of the cave where we see the children of the forest are already out there looking, and the Night's King's there, like, Mummy, I'm home! And Mare is like, fucking ball as the Night's King shows off a new power as he has magic earthquake powers on ice. So he like touches the ground of the ice and it sends this shock wave down and starts to bring down the tree. So just to kind of create confusion, Mare is like fucking balls and the Night's King shows off the power and the leaf yells, get Bran and get the fuck out of there. So Mira heads inside and the Army of the Dead starts marching on the cave and they just can't, they can't fucking wait. They're like happy to come there. They're marching in. Mira comes in, tries to wake Bran up, but no, fucking Hodor's upset as shit. He's trying to get things up. Bran is in his dream. Bran is with the Three-Eyed Raven in Winterfell again, watching Ned hug Brandon, and then Ned is getting taken off to the Eyrie. Bran is enjoying this. He's got, he has a smile on his face. Mm-hmm. The Red Raven looks scared as shit. Like, he knows what's going to happen. The Blood Raven knows what's going to happen.
Oh, yeah.
Blood Raven watches the whole thing as we cut to the Army of Dead getting closer and closer. She's trying to get, she, Mira starts going, Hodor, we need your help. We need your fucking help. And she's dragging Bran as much as she can. And the children are trying to do their thing, throwing the fire bombs and shit, which looks a lot cooler this year. Of just like,
Hodor knows, yes, he's been nice. Here before. It all came back to him in this moment. Like,
full circle. It all full circle. And then the White Walkers, I mean, the Whites start converging on the cave. Like ants. You know, if you drop some food at the beach and the ants just converge
swarm,
on the,
yes.
Swarm on it, it's like that. They just all start swarming on the fucking thing. And we get to Bran trying to get, Mira's trying to get into his mind. She's like, listen, wake up. And it's just a great moment with, we see Ned and his dad. Don't fight, but if you have to fight, win, as Ned's going off to the Vale. Then we see Bran and Mira. Mira's trying the best to get him out of there. A few of the whites, come from the top of the tree, and she kills one. She kills another one. Leaf kills one. As Hodor starts the chant, eventually, that when Bran hops into his mind in the dream, it starts the hold the door chant that just starts on shivers down my spine.
Oh, yeah.
Mara starts begging, you need to wake up, Bran. You need to warg inside Hodor because we need your fucking help. And a White Walker ends up coming in. Everything goes into panic mode. Leaf kind of, or one of the children of the forest stabs one of the White Walkers in the gut with the dragon glass, but it doesn't work. And then Mira throws a spear of dragon glass to the White Walker's face, and it hits him, and he kind of smashes and goes crazy. They're all heading. It's just a quick cut. It all gets intense as Blood Raven's just miserable, like he knew this was going to happen the whole time. Brandon starts to hear these cries from Mira in the dream. Hodor, jump into Hodor. We need you to get you into Hodor. And just looks confused. And he hears the wake up, and then we see Hodor. We see young Hodor. And this is when Bran, from my approximation, wargs into Hodor in the past, which connects into Hodor in the future, and Bran takes over Hodor's body, and then we see a flash on modern day Hodor, and then a flash on past Hodor, who just starts screaming, hold the door, as Mira starts saying, hold the door, hold the door, hold the door. And then Summer steps up. I'm going all over the place with this. I'm not necessarily doing this in correct order. Summer also shows up at a point in time, and we already talked about this. Summer steps up and buys them some more time. Then Leaf buys them some more time by being a suicide bomber. Winter's fucking here when Summer's dead. They're all running away. The army's on their asses. Then they get close up to the Night's King comes close up to Blood Raven, and they're like face to face as Blood Raven talks now back in time. It's a weird like sound cue where we kind of don't necessarily hear it, but we hear it in the past. And Blood Raven's like, listen, now is the time that you take me off. Yes, you need to take over for me. And you need to become me. And right at that point, the Night's King stabs Blood Raven, and we see him in the dream with Bran break up into like black oil or black smoke of some sort and just kind of liquefy and then go off to Bran heading to the door outside the tree. And another sacrifice, Leaf decides to sacrifice herself too. She grabs up one of her balls, does a self-sacrifice. Finally, they get to the door. They get outside, and it's hurry, everyone get out the door. Hold the door.
Oh, gosh.
And then Willis starts having convulsions and starts freaking out in the past and just fucking, the music gets intense as he's Hodor, and he just knows it. And then there's a moment where he jumps out and young Hodor looks at Bran and sees Bran and he knows it all. It's all fucking connected. And what the fuck? And it's fucking grabbing me by the balls, ripping my emotions, punching me over and over and over. What the fuck? And they kill Hodor. They kill fucking Summer. I don't give a shit about the children before, but they kill them all. What the fuck was that, Joe? And I just lost it. Lost it. Watched the episode twice today, once in the morning and then once at night. And I fucking cried both times. Right now, I'm like trying to hold it together. I'm fucking crying, dude.
My eyes are a little watery listening to the recap.
Fucking dude, I'm all over the place with this thing, but it's just because I'm emotional. I'm trying to fucking yada out of this bullshit. So fucking Hodor fucking saves the day, and the way that they show it and the screams of the Hodor, like that was what did it. Like that scene could have been not done as well, but it was done well, mainly because of the young actor, the kid's performance of screaming, hold the door.
Yeah. It was awesome.
It was just so emotionally fucking amazing. Just really amazing stuff. Yeah, that whole scene was really well done. We've put the Will Smith from I Am Legend, Cicero Ogbon Dixonstein. The White Walker walking through the fire looked cool. The scene was crazy, scary, awesome looking, says Timo. Yeah, she took it like a champ. She took those stabs. Yeah, she did take those stabs well. And I also feel like how much they stabbed Summer too. That was really horrible. Like they just really got into Summer, and that was the end of our episode, folks. And that was it. And I'm trying to hold my shit together a little bit. Let's take a couple calls here at the end before we call it an evening. Welcome to the show, 1-1. Are you there, 1-1?
1-1.
Are you there, 1-1-1? Hello, you're on the air. We lost 1-1. Area code 813. You're on the air, 813. What's going on? Hello, you're on the air. Okay. 813, I'm putting you on hold. I'm not hanging up on you, so I'm putting you on hold in case you come back. Let's go to our good buddy, Jay. Jay, what's going on, buddy? Did you tear up in the Hodor scene? Did you tear up in the Hodor scene?
I think I'm too I'm too deadened by all the violence that has happened on the show.
You've been desensitized. Really.
Like, the last thing that made me feel something really emotional is when they stabbed John. And that was just like, because I knew it was coming because I didn't read the books, but I read like the wiki, so I knew that scene was going to be. It took me like I don't know, weeks and months later, and I actually watched him being stabbed because that's something I couldn't take or whatever.
No, I hear you, bro.
Before that, I think the other thing that got me emotional was like Joffrey's death, but that was emotional and like he's finally dead, but it was kind of bittersweet because I didn't think he died painfully enough. And the other thing was the Red Wedding or whatever. That made me emotional, but the other thing was Shaggy Dog. Like I would have had an easier time if they had just given Rickon's head to Ramsay and then shown a live Shaggy Dog as the proof, rather than them giving Shaggy Dog to Ramsay. I would have had an easier time with that.
Yes. Good stuff.
Kind of shows how screwed I am.
Awesome stuff though. I may be screwed up, but I think we all are a little bit, my friend. Great call as always. I'm looking forward to hearing from you on the feedback show, my friend. Great stuff as always this week. It's always great to hear you. One of our first callers. Yeah. We always always thankful that you get to call in, my friend. So let's take 813 again. 813, what's going on? Are you there, my friend? Going once, going twice. I'm gonna keep you on the air for a second just in case you catch
that. So this was my I gotta say, maybe it was because I read the books. So I guess it's kind of the opposite of him, but so I knew mostly all of the deaths were coming, but I didn't read them until after I saw season one. So Ned Stark's death hit me pretty big, but this was the biggest death in like it hurt me the most. As a fan and as a viewer, since that, and it might have to do with the fact that I didn't that I had read the books and knew everything else that was going to happen. So the show, I kind of expected these things for the show and was interested to see how they were going to do them.
Yeah.
So this was the first thing, like, I didn't expect Hodor was dying today. I didn't expect...
Someone said in the chat, I do want to
point out he was dying at all.
That someone said in the chat that that Dan and Dave and their, I don't know if this was in their post-episode shit, said that the death of Hodor came from George R. R. Martin. I don't know. Can someone please recap the whole episode? I missed it. Please recap. Hodor and Summer died energy. I'm sorry. It's horrible.
To me, it was just shock all around. And then it was super fucking sad to see how Hodor became Hodor and that he's had to live his whole life having seen his death through the, like, through his own older eye, just all sorts of fucked up shit there.
Great performances on both Willis and Hodor's part.
David asked the question that Red Wedding was too much of a shock for me, says Timo. David said something like, did Hodor... question for the show, am I mistaken, or did it seem like Hodor had regained his ability to speak there at the end as he was yelling? He did seem to become, to be snapped into reality for a second. I do want to play this call from one of my favorite friends and great, fucking great person, Amanda, who I was talking to earlier today. I believe this is from Amanda, and this is a voicemail from her. So let's play the voicemail right now.
Hey, Phil, I'm just popping in and out of the live stream, but... Oh man, like the ending part of this episode was just so intense. Like I was really shocked. I didn't even know what to do. I couldn't move. I couldn't breathe. I didn't realize I hadn't been breathing until the credits rolled and I was just like hyperventilating and sobbing.
Right.
Oh God, that was so hard. That was so hard to hear Summer jumping into the fray and
so hard. And by the way, I just saw that you popped in who this message is from. Just Smiles just popped in the live chat, so perfect timing actually. So let's play the rest of the
door, like seriously, like hold the door. I'm like, this is all crazy, and I'm like, and the craziness, I guess there's a lot of
perfect timing,
like, really intricate like details like to pay attention to, like this whole timeline is messed up. Like why did Hodor just like start saying Hodor then? Like it was happening in the future, so there's like some kind of like time warp thing. I don't even know what's going on, but like,
let's do the time warp. Oh, sorry.
Even process it. It was so painful. I think, you know, from when I messaged you, I was like, this is just the most like insanely painful episode I've ever seen. For me, it's worse than the Red Wedding. It's worse than anything. I have never cried so hard in my life. And I just wanted to kind of share my emotions.
You have had a good life.
Yeah.
I feel sad and like, oh, this is great television, or if they screwed everything up and they're doing wrong by the characters, especially by the Darrow ones. I'm like, why are they all dying? It's depressing me. But anyway, that's my long voicemail, and thanks for the great show.
Thank you. I think you mean
the hardest you've cried at a TV show your whole life, and that I'm in the same boat, but if that's the hardest you've cried in your whole life, you probably got a good life.
Yes, keep it up, then congratulations.
I think sometimes, just in fairness, I've cried more for the events that happen after the bad events, for like little things. Like when my grandmother, who was kind of like my mother, died, I cried more when my cat died a couple months after she died, more than I cried when my grandmother died, because I was crying about both of them. I was like, oh my God, cat died with Miles, what the fuck about? You know, I like started freaking out, and I was like freaking out more because of my grandmother, more than that. So I think sometimes, these artistic situations or whatever in life, they can really help focus the emotion that you're feeling.
Yes, absolutely.
Over a TV, she says over a TV show, Joe.
Yeah.
Over a TV show. So let's jump in the live chat before we call it a night. Definitely worse than the Red Wedding, says the odd out. Should have ran. Rev says, seems like they heard Mira's voice, like who's present in the future with Bran at the same time as Bran warged in the past. D&D aren't very smart, says Aereo. Madcap says, I thought the same thing. Oh, I thought the same thing as someone above. I've never cried so much in a TV show. I hate Game of Thrones now, but I'll keep watching, says Eric. Summer was smart. She knew they needed a distraction, says Timo. I'm all about that, Timo. Great call. Smiles. Tyrion, Jon, Danny all ride dragons and kill White Walkers. Next week's twist, Sparrow told Cersei the Queen of Thorns murdered Joffrey. All Tyrells die. Summer and Shaggy Dog had to die because CG butter was used for Melisandre's granny body. Spoiler, whatever emotions you feel when tragedies strike is beautiful. It's real. It's raw. It makes you, you. Did they ever take anyone out of the wall to bring it down? Did they take everyone out of the wall to bring it down? I think so. Hodor is like that dog you've had for years. This is the best episode to watch on acid. White Walker, Hodor versus Zombie Mountain. I take Zombie Mountain in that one, right. I think.
Yeah.
I don't know. Yeah, Joe. White Walker, Hodor versus Zombie Mountain.
Franken Mountain.
I take the Franken Mountain because I think he's just a killing machine. And I think White Hodor would probably be pretty scary too, though. Oh my God. That's actually really tough.
Yes.
I think.
Neither one of them die until they're set on fire, though, right?
We don't know what kills the
Franken Mountain.
We don't know what kills the Franken Mountain, Joe, to be honest. We don't. That's a different sort of thing.
God, get that TV show that does like the mechanical bear versus the or some shit.
They do the digital versions on. Yeah, that's actually pretty good.
Or they do like the Ultimate Warrior one where they do like the Zimbabwe Warrior versus the Maori Warrior shit.
So now is about as good a time as any to start to wrap things up. I just want to thank everyone, like seriously, everyone, the FOPs that are in the live Discord group now and all the motherfucking chat that's in there.
Andrew,
thank you to Ariel, Andrew, Anthony, Arthur, Baghead, Benjamin, Bruce, Carl, Clayton, Craig, Cody, Doria, Ellie, Energy, Eric, Folk Blues, G Dozer, George fucking Washington, the dude in the dollar bill, Geraldo, Heavenly Bear, Ian, James, John, Kimberly, Len, Ninja, Patrick, fucking Weekend Doctor, yes. Tom himself, huge thanks, William, everybody, Timo, if you haven't, the Finn, Walking David, Sergio, Snatch, any of those people that I haven't mentioned, the Odd Out, if I haven't mentioned any of you guys, thank you so much. SM, all of our friends that called in the live chat, all of that. Are you there, caller? Is there anybody there? Hello, caller? Do you exist? Hello? Caller, are you there? I was going to try to take one last caller of the night, but that is good. We'll call that an evening. So Young Willis reviled his death relived his death pretty much. Did Hodor know the whole time that this whole thing would lead to his death? I think so.
Yes.
That's how I read it. That is absolutely how I read it.
He's been holding on to this since that day.
But someone says they love tacos. Love you, Phil. Love Katie Kerr. If you haven't already, if you enjoyed our video, please hit that subscribe button. Please hit that like button. Help us grow. Share it with a friend. Help bring more people to the community to help talk and rant and have some fun about this episode. Thank you, Sir Alec von Lichtenstein, Timo, any of the people that popped in that group. All of you guys mean so much to us. You can follow me on Twitter at IGotIssuesMan. Follow Joe at DirtyLocks. Find Katie on Google+ at CatCrow. If you haven't already, add me on Google+ too. Helps us to get to the point where we can be verified or something. It's all about like adding on Google+ and all that stuff, I've come to find out. So if you can do that, please do that. Lots of other stuff in the description box if you want to find more information about us, how to subscribe to the audio podcast, how to maybe buy a t-shirt if you want to buy a t-shirt, donate to us via PayPal or Patreon, that kind of stuff. If you want to send us some stuff, you can email me at igotissuesman@gmail.com. I can send you guys the address or check my Twitter or the Google group or any of the places that has a mailing address for us. All of that fun stuff. If you haven't already, please also subscribe to Dirty Issues Gaming if you like gaming streaming. Joe is over there having a lot of fun. There might be another surprise coming there pretty soon. We'll talk about that, some more action going on there. I don't want to talk too much about that yet, but someone might be joining us to create some content on the channel a little bit more. So it's a little bit of a tease for that. So everyone, thank you so much for joining us this week. We will be back Wednesday or Thursday to do a feedback show. I will try to create that vent as early as possible so we know when that is happening. But everyone, thank you so much for joining us tonight. Cannot say enough thanks to all of you guys. You guys are fucking awesome. And it's been so much fun to talk to you every week, and it's gonna be so much fun to be able to talk to you guys every week for the rest of the season and fucking join us and help more people join us for the remainder of this Game of Thrones, so we can all fucking have as much fun as possible together talking about this show. So everybody, thank you so much. As I'm stalling for a little bit of time to get to the music, a little bit of music stall, Let's play. People seem to like this one tonight. So let's play this one tonight. Everybody, good night. Talk to you soon.
Love.
Peace. never gonna hold the door again.
Has any questions that haven't been answered or you want answered, please leave a voicemail at the 781-990-8509 and we'll get to it on the voicemail and the text show. And if any of you guys left voicemails or texts tonight that we didn't get to, all those will be gotten to in that show. So look forward to talking to you then.